The Daytona International Speedway on a cloudy and, for Florida, very cool Saturday. Despite the chill, it's a special place and a special time for racers and race fans. The start of a new season at the sport's most famous track. Since men first began testing the limits of themselves and their machines on the hard-packed sands of Daytona Beach in the early 1900s, this community along Florida's East Coast has been a dream destination for those who want to know how fast they can go. The Speedway opened in 1959, unlike anything else that existed at the time. Through the years, thousands have challenged these high banks. Those who've succeeded have become famous. Those who've succeeded repeatedly have become legends. Some of today's biggest NASCAR stars are ready to pursue another cherished trophy, as are rising young stars hoping for a memorable upset, and one famous lady chasing her own Daytona dream. A new season begins at world famous Daytona next. Welcomes you to NASCAR Countdown, presented by Hellmann's. As the 2010 NASCAR Nationwide Series opens at the Daytona International Speedway in Daytona Beach, Florida. The final practice session for tomorrow's Daytona 500 has just concluded, and as those cars roll back into their garage, the 15 drivers from the 500 field who are also running today's 300-miler have just a couple of moments to talk to their teams, grab a bite to eat, and then head out to the stage and be introduced and buckle in. Let's hit some of the headline stories of today with the four reporters who patrol the pit area for us, starting with Vince Welch.
Well, Alan, the smallest driver has been the biggest story this week here in the Nationwide Garage. 5'2", 100-pound Danica Patrick has been swarmed by media and fans alike as she's prepared to make her NASCAR debut here today at Daytona. But that hornet's nest is nothing compared to what she's about to experience. But it raises the big question, are 3.5 hours of practice enough to get Danica ready for NASCAR at Daytona? We're about to find out. Dave Burns.
Vince, plenty of practice for some of NASCAR's biggest stars right here at the Daytona International Speedway. Six former winners in the field today. Earnhardt, Tony Stewart's number four car here, Kyle Busch, and then eight former champions, including Carl Edwards and Greg Biffle, who have never won at Daytona International Speedway in the NASCAR Nationwide Series. Today could be their day at NASCAR's biggest stage. Jamie Little.
Well, Dave, the future of the Nationwide Series is alive and well today. We have four Rookie of the Year candidates, 22 years of age and younger, but it's the youngest driver in the field, Trevor Bayne, at 18 years old, who could be the dark horse. Now, you mix those youngsters with the many veteran drivers, and you're bound to get some thrills and spills at Daytona. Dr. Jerry Punch?
Well, if you want to make the hair on the back of a race fan's neck stand up, just mention the word Daytona. This place, arguably the most hallowed ground in all of American stock car racing. In this race, the richest and most prestigious event of the year. A good run here can get you a sponsor. A great run here could launch your career. And if you just happen to win this race, your name will be added alongside some of the all-time greats in the sport, like Earnhardt, Waltrip, Allison, or Stewart. Folks, this is not just a race. And this is not just a place. This is Daytona. Alan?
Doc, thanks. Fans come from all across the country, some from overseas, to be at Daytona. And it's always a thrill to have our ESPN pit studio right in the middle of all the buzz and excitement here at the World Center of Racing. We welcome you inside that particular vehicle. Alan Bestwick, along with former champion driver Rusty Wallace, NASCAR team owner Brad Daugherty, and former champion crew chief Ray Evernham, all comfortably seated where it's heated. Not something you normally are looking for on a Florida day with the palm trees outside, that's for sure. It's new season. It's Daytona.
You said it right there, Daytona. I'm telling you what, when I was a young guy and living in St. Louis, Missouri, and I'd come down here to race, got my first opportunity. And I'll never forget driving through the tunnel here at Daytona. It was the most incredible feeling I've ever had in my life. The big tunnel down, and you come into the big, big racetrack, and you knew you were at the big race. And you knew you weren't just at another race. You were at the big one. You were at Daytona. And if somehow, just like Jerry Punch said, if you won this thing, it was everything in the world to me. I thought about this one, and I had my very, very prepared for it as a driver. And when I come through that tunnel, like I said, I flip a switch. I'm another person. I'm ready to go.
You know, as a fan, it's been a long 84 days, baby, waiting to hear these hot rods thundering around this racetrack. And we start with the biggest race of the year, probably the most important race of the year, with a Daytona race. So it's exciting to be here. I think with what's going on with the rules and the packages that they're giving the drivers with these cars, we could see bedlam before the end of the day. It's going to be big.
Le Mans, Bonneville, Indianapolis, Daytona. Those are the names that you know as a racer. And when you come through that tunnel as a crew chief or an owner, as a driver, you know that winning at a place like this, winning here, is a career day. It makes you part of auto racing history.
And it never gets old coming to Daytona. You talk about coming up through the tunnel, it never gets old. No matter how many times you come here, it's a special place. Doc Punch mentioned some of the big names that have won this race before. Take a look at some of the past multiple winners of this NASCAR Nationwide Series. Series 300 miler at Daytona. You've got people like Darrell Waltrip.
Yeah, I mean, legend of the sport. You see those three career wins here in the Nationwide Series. Had a heck of a career as a champion and was big time when he came to Daytona.
Dale Jr. certainly as good as anybody that's ever driven in a Nationwide car. Five total wins, a few more wins to gain on his dad, yep. But today could be the day he closes that gap.
And what about this guy right here, Tony Stewart? He's won the last four out of five Nationwide races in February here at Daytona. And in practice, this guy was blistering fast. All the drivers are talking about him.
Dale Earnhardt won this race 5 years in a row. Seven wins in this race for Earnhardt. Daytona legend, fair to say.
Yeah, without question.
And they want to be like him, too.
Yeah. Someone's going to take home a Daytona trophy today. That's headline number one. Headline number two is the NASCAR debut of Danica Patrick, experiencing a Daytona race morning for the first time. Up next, the story of what led Patrick, whose background is in open-wheel racing, to give Daytona stock cars a try.
I'm really looking forward to getting out there with the Cup guys. I want to learn from them. I want to earn their respect. You know, I'm going to be like, Dale, go out there. Where are we going to run? Show me what we're going to do. Hit me. I don't care. You know, how does it go? How do you guys do it? I'm going to try and sort of disconnect from the result. And if it goes well, that's great. And that's obviously a result of preparation and the process. But, you know, it's not the be-all, end-all. So I think that's really just going to come down to improving every time.
NASCAR Countdown is presented by the mayonnaise that's real and delicious, Hellman's, and in part by Lipitor.
The field of cars in today's NASCAR Nationwide Series race at Daytona International Speedway now formed up on the grid. Let me mention that qualifying was rained out here yesterday. The field lined up according to provisions in the NASCAR rulebook, putting Kyle Busch in the 18 and Carl Edwards in the 60, the top two in last year's points on the front row. Lined up 15th on the grid will be car 7. The Chevy Danica Patrick will wheel in her NASCAR debut today. To a hardcore NASCAR fan, Patrick is just one of 43 drivers in the field. But as the crowds around the 7 car in the garage all week long illustrate, her presence in this race has drawn attention far beyond normal NASCAR circles after Danica decided to mix it up with racing's good old boys.
Boys, move over! The lady is coming through!
Danica Patrick leads the Indianapolis 500. Here comes Danica Patrick.
It's absolutely amazing.
So we don't need the headlines. We don't need the headlines. We just won.
I'll be driving the number 7 GoDaddy car in for Junior Motorsports. Extremely proud to be able to give her this honor and to be the team that leads her into NASCAR.
There was a bunch of different things that made me say right now is the right time. I'm ready for the challenge. I'm just ready emotionally. There were lots of things that played into the team that I went with. I spent, you know, quite a few trips out to Charlotte in summertime last year, meeting with teams, meeting with owners, drivers, getting people's opinions on what I should do and where I should go. Junior Motorsports was one of those that wasn't really in the picture. After Brad said that he was leaving and going to Penske, then it left a seat open. With the decision to run a full IndyCar schedule and then some Nationwide races this year, I thought about the option of just racing an IndyCar, just racing stock cars, whether it was, no matter what it was. And then the best of both worlds was kind of to do both of them. It's going to take a while to learn this racing. What if I don't like it? What if I get over here and drive the cars and I'm like, ooh, this is not for me, but have already made that jump, and then all of a sudden, what the heck do you do then? So before I was able to sort of be, I don't know, have my license, get qualified, be entered fully into stock car racing, I had to fill out a resume. I had to put what I had accomplished, what tracks I had raced at, which I just skipped that one because there's just too many, and where I finished and all that, and I can't remember. And then I also had to put, names, references on there that they could call, and I felt really funny writing down names like Bobby Rahal, Michael Andretti, and Rusty Wallace.
Danica Patrick is in the seat of a stock car for the first time.
Green flag, green flag.
Danica Patrick all the way up to fifth now. That's the highest she's run.
Might have had a brake check happen right here, about three cars in front of you, too.
People brake check a lot.
You can't get the cars stopped with the brakes that are on them. You can't get them stopped in a situation like that, so.
Tony is really smart. He knows a lot about the car. I want him to explain things to me, but at the same time, I don't always completely understand him. You know, I'm trying to learn, but he talks over my head a little bit, but that's okay because I have a very limited amount of knowledge right now.
Nelson Piquet Jr. forces her down off the racetrack. Look at this drive through the grass she has.
Hold on to it.
I'll tell you, this right here is car control. Now, that's something that you got it or you don't.
I suppose I didn't expect to have to go through the grass, what seemed like almost crash. But on the other hand, it was also a really great thing because it also showed that, one, I caught it with Tony's help, but two, that I'm not going to move and I'm not going to back off.
Man, I'm rolling. I'm rolling. The side of the car. This thing is not going to be pretty when it comes back.
Way to come back up through there. You've done awesome. Be proud of yourself. I know you learned a lot tonight.
I was mostly just kind of like beaming with happiness, and like I had so much fun rubbing and the passing and, you know, all that stuff happened in the last 20 laps. I was just really excited to be out there. I had just so much fun in a race car. It's like getting off a roller coaster and being like giddy happy, and you want to get on it again.
And again, the 7 car that Patrick will steer coming from the Junior Motorsports stable, lined up in the 15th position on the grid. Danica only made her stock car debut here 7 days ago, but she is a very accomplished racer. From spending time in Europe as a teenager on the tough road racing development trail to the top level of American open wheel racing, she's finished in the top 10 4 times and 5 tries in the Indy 500 and was 5th in points in the Izod IndyCar Series last year. Today's her NASCAR first. For Patrick's pre-race thoughts, we go to Vince Welch.
Well, Alan, she's definitely been the belle of the ball. There's at least 100 fans around us right now as we get ready to visit with Danica. You've admitted that you have some anxieties before races. How big are the butterflies right now?
I'm pretty nervous, I'm not going to lie. This car is definitely more challenging to drive than the ARCA car. It's definitely more on the edge. So these guys all know what they're doing. Not like they didn't know what they were doing in ARCA, but there's just more of them now, you know. And also some Cup guys. It'll be a pretty good day if I can see some Cup bumpers that are starting up front. And then you got Tony Stewart coming through. So it's sure to be interesting. But I just, plan on being smart and staying in line and being patient, just kind of like the ARCA race last weekend, just following the leader and assess my car for a stint before I start getting crazy.
You've been in plenty of big races. You've driven in the Indianapolis 500, other big races. How does the pressure you feel right now compare to, say, before an Indy 500?
Well, you definitely feel like it's an Indy 500 here at Daytona. It's the biggest race of the year for NASCAR. There's so many fans. I've been here for 2 weeks, so it feels like I'm at Indy for a long time. And you can just feel the history and the importance. So I think anytime there's a lot on the line, you get more nervous because you just want to do well. You want to do well when it's a big one.
How have you adjusted to this race car this week?
I think that it's good that we've had so much practice, really. I mean, a couple hours here and there and getting to run in traffic and not having to really be preoccupied with qualifying. So that was kind of nice. We even threw some things at it before qualifying that we're like, if we qualify or don't, we're going to be in the race. So it's not a question. So it's nice to have that kind of comfort. And so we were able to really get out there and just run in some groups.
Finally, what defines a successful day for Danica Patrick today?
You guys always ask that question, and I think you're looking for some position answer, and I'm not going to give it because I don't know what it is, you know? I think that, you know, I think if the GoDaddy car comes back with a couple rings on the side and a dented bumper and I finish the race, then to be honest, I think that's a good day. You know, I think that means I've raced hard and kept it going mostly forwards.
Yeah, it'd be a good day indeed. Congratulations on a good week so far. Thanks for the time.
Thanks,
Danica Patrick. Alan?
All right, Vince, thanks. And it's been the scene all week, the crowd of people around the garage, the crowd of people around the hauler, and there'll be a crowd of people watching today as that 7 car carries Danica Patrick through her first ever NASCAR stock car race and her second stock car race here at Daytona. Interesting, because I was going to ask you guys, you think there's a couple of butterflies? She admitted there's more than a couple of butterflies.
Well, I'm glad she said there is butterflies out there. She is nervous. I mean, can you imagine, though? Think about this now. She's went to the Indianapolis 500. I mean, she's experienced a lot of the drama there. That's 33 cars. She's got 43 cars here, and she's never been in this type of stock car at Daytona. I just can't imagine the pressure that she has inside of her. She's pretty calm looking, but I got to tell you guys, when she gets on that racetrack with 43 of the country's best drivers, she's got to be all tensed up, but I believe in order for her to ever have a good day, she's going to have to keep this thing from getting in a wreck. She's going to have to be careful out there. She's going to have to listen to her spotters. And above all, guys, she's got to just bring this car home. But a lot of pressure on this young lady.
Yeah, and she's talking about the media asking about the defining success. That comes from me, by the way. I ask her all week. I ask her, I said, you know, how are you going to put into perspective, you know, what you've accomplished this week? If it's a short-term situation where you're only going to run, you know, maybe 10, 12 races, how are you going to be able to have a barometer there over such a short period of time? Now, if you're all in, what happens? And she said, look, I'm trying to get better each race. That's what I want to do. That's what's important. So it's going to be interesting. She's going to be with some cats today, though, that are going to cut her no slack. That ARCA field the other day, half the field wrecked. So she got a good finish. She did a good job. But today is a whole different ballgame.
Ray, you've been paying a lot of attention to the practice, the race, radio communication, that kind of thing. Your impressions of what you've seen and heard so far?
Well, what I heard really was exactly what I've seen, except for the part where she said she had butterflies, because after watching the GoDaddy commercials, I can't believe she's going to be intimidated by any of this. But, you know, but she said she's smart, she's patient, and she's been those things. But eavesdropping on her and Tony Urie this week, we have heard what a good description, how good she's been about the feedback and asking the right questions. Now, in an IndyCar, you've got a computer to help you do that. Here she doesn't. She has to be the computer, and she's done a great job at that at this week. Doing that, and I was very impressed with it.
Maybe one barometer of measuring success, other open-wheel drivers who've come to NASCAR, Dario Franchitti, Sam Hornish, so on, and how they fared in their first race here at Daytona. Something maybe to think about for later on. Now, this is not Danica's first stock car race here at Daytona, but there are notable differences between the car she drove in the ARCA Series race 1 week ago and the Nationwide Series car she'll drive today. For more on that, let's go to our Craftsman Tech Garage and bring in champion crew chief Tim Brewer. Brew, what you got?
Alan, four changes come to mind. One, the ARCA car didn't have a roof deflector. This roof deflector, what it does is makes a bigger hole in the air. It's kind of like following a Suburban down the road, then jumping off there and getting behind a big tractor and trailer. It's going to make a lot easier for the drafting. Another thing, the other car had a flat spoiler in this area. Here on the Nationwide car, we have a gurney lip. What that does is provides more drag as well as downforce. The next big change is the tires. The Hoosier tire was on the ARCA car. In this series, we run a Goodyear tire, which the compound, the softness of the rubber, and the construction of the tire have different handling characteristics. Another thing, the wheelbase. From the center of this axle to the front axle, it's 5 inches difference. What that's going to do, it's shorter, it's not going to ride the bumps as well, and it's going to make the car turn in a little bit better. But she's adapted real well to all the scenarios, and she'll do that again today. Alan?
Just like he used to do on his race cars, Brewer's been rubbing and buffing on all that stuff in the Craftsman Tech Garage all winter. Tim, thanks. We look forward to hearing from you throughout the race. Let's bring in two more of our champions on our ESPN NASCAR team. Three-time Daytona 500 winner Dale Jarrett and two-time champion crew chief Andy Petrie upstairs getting ready to call the action today. Gentlemen, as you watch the race unfold, what are you going to be looking for from Patrick?
Well, she's getting ready to encounter something that she hasn't all week long. She's put herself in different positions drafting, but she's getting out there now with 43 cars and drivers that are serious about what's going to happen on this day. You know, I talked earlier in the week about it was kind of like she went through high school last week and graduated through that with the ARCA race. Well, she's completed her first year of college with these 3.5 hours of practice. Now she's going to cram 3 more years into these 300 miles and see what she can learn. But I look for her, just like she said, to kind of take it easy at the first of this race. And then as we get towards the end of these 300 miles, I think she's going to be a lot more aggressive. It'll be fun to watch as she gets a little more aggressive and see what she can do.
I've been impressed how smart she is. You know, the smartest people I know are the ones that know what they don't know and they ask questions. And she's done that all week here. And how she applies all these answers and the things she's learned in practice is going to make it or break it for her today. And the other thing is listening to her spotter and doing what he tells her to do and doing it in a timely fashion.
Now, Andy, something else particularly interesting to you to watch today will be pit stops for Patrick.
Yeah, that's one detail that can just absolutely ruin their day. And what Tony Urie Jr. has to do is to tell her, don't let your focus come down. When that caution comes out or we get ready to make a pit stop, I want you to really pay attention, because getting in your pit stall and then getting back out without damaging the car, all these small details can knock you right out of contention in this race. So she's really got to pay attention to her crew chief.
Andy Petrie, Dale Jarrett. Gentlemen, thanks. We look forward to your call to the race in just a little while. Now, Danica Patrick is not the only female driver in today's race. Rusty's niece, Chrissy, the 21-year-old daughter of Mike Wallace, starts 35th in her first ever Nationwide Series race.
Yeah, you know, Chrissy Wallace, I've actually watched guys way back when she was driving Legends cars. Well, not way back, but a few years ago. She was a good little racer in the Legends Series. Moved up into late models, was the first young lady to ever win at Hickory Motor Speedway. Had 5 wins in late models. She can do it. She has got some talent. And she's in a tough starting spot. Probably doesn't have the strongest car, but she can go.
I'll tell you what, she's had some pretty good finishes. 19th at Martinsville, 13th at Talladega, so she knows how to get it done.
Yeah, she's a good driver.
Father-daughter in the same Nationwide Series race for the first time at Daytona today. Mike Wallace in the field as well. I'm telling you, it is cold for Florida.
Boy, it is, man.
All apologies to those in the north with all the snow in the Midwest, but they're bundled up here, still on hand and ready to see some racing at Daytona for the Nationwide Series. Making memories at Daytona, where fans lucky enough to have pre-race access passes, signing their name on the start-finish line and taking a picture of that, something they'll probably remember for the rest of their lives. The stage set up, driver introductions beginning shortly before today's NASCAR Nationwide Series race. The first race of a new season always brings a lot of new faces. Ricky Stenhouse, the 22-year-old Mississippi native, going to drive the Roush Fenway number 6 Ford full-time this year. Brian Scott moves over from the Truck Series, the Idaho native, in Braun Racing's number 11 Toyota. John Westhound, sophomore year, will be with Richard Childress Racing, the Georgia driver in the number 21 Chevrolet. And Texan Colin Brown takes over Roush Fenway's number 16. Some of the new faces and new places you'll see today. Doc Punch, who you got?
I got Colin Brown, Alan, a 21-year-old driver running for Rookie of the Year this year. And Colin, as a rookie, what's your biggest challenge here today at Daytona?
Well, I think the biggest challenge is racing with the Cup drivers. You know, there's so many of those guys that have so much experience. You know, and luckily for me, I've got some really good Cup drivers on my own team with Carl Edwards and Paul Menard. So hopefully we can work with those guys and get this number 16 Conway Freight Ford Fusion to the front.
Hey, Colin, in all 8 of your previous Nationwide starts, you had Eddie Perdue, your crew chief today, calling the shots. How's that going to help you now this year?
Well, I think having a crew chief like Eddie, with all the experience that he has, this whole number 16 group, all these guys have been together for so long, that I think we're going to have a really good, we're going to click well. I've had him before, like you said, so we kind of know what to build on, what to work on, and I think that's going to be a big help today.
Good luck today.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Alan, Colin Brown is another new face hooking up with an established team.
Starting in the 9th spot today. Thanks, Doc. Now, there are also, at the start of a new season, some familiar faces in new places as well. Greg Biffle is going to drive Baker Curb Racing's 27 car this year. Biff drove for the team in 05, 06, and 07. Brad Keselowski moves from Junior Motorsports to a Penske Dodge. Instead of 88, his new number is 22. The Braun 38 will be a shared seat this year. Casey Kane will drive today and 7 other times. The other races, Jason Leffler will be in that car, while Leffler drives Braun's number 10 in the events where Kane is in the 38. Let's hear from Kane. He's with Vince.
It's been a good week already for Casey Kane, and a good car in the cup practice that just finished up. You won the Gatorade Duel, the second Gatorade Duel on Thursday. I know it's a different car, different series than what you run today, but how does winning one of the Gatorade Duels maybe boost your confidence for this race?
Well, it feels good. I had never won at Daytona, so it was kind of an accomplishment. You know, I felt good about it, and our team has been really quick. These guys do a great job, and we had another good practice. So I think tomorrow for the 500, we're looking pretty good. Today, we start eighth because of Loeffler's points from last year, so we have a good starting spot. We just need to figure out how to keep the Great Clips Toyota up there. It was kind of off in practice, so we'll see what we can do.
Off in what way?
Just couldn't draft as good as we did in July. In July, I felt like we were one of the best cars, and got beat up a little bit car-wise, but I thought we had one of the best cars there. And just in practice, I couldn't push, and if cars were pushing me, they could just pull by and pass. So hopefully with a lot more cars, it'll wake our car up a little bit, and maybe we'll have a shot.
We'll see something to keep our eye on that. Hopefully it'll work out for Casey Kane, Alan.
Kane starting eighth today, looking for his car to wake up. That's a pretty good description. Rusty Brad Ray, as you look at the lineup and the different faces and different places for this year, what intrigues you?
I would say what's intriguing me is Brad Keselowski in the number 22 car, the Penske car. He drove for Junior Motorsports last year, and this year he's got this new ride that he's driving, and he's looked really good in practice right now, so I've got my eye on him at the moment.
Yeah, for me, it's Ton Broad's operation. I mean, he has got four entries this year into the Nationwide Series, which is great, but I'm looking for them to get to victory lane. I mean, he's got, you know, Reed Sorensen, Brian Vickers, Casey Kane, Brian Scott, and the veteran Jason Loeffler of the series sharing these vehicles, and I need to see them get to victory lane more. They're ready.
Well, they always talk about putting up and shutting up. Well, I want to talk about this guy. We're not going to get him to shut up, all right? But he put up. You know, his team this year, they've switched to Toyota. They've got an alliance with Gibbs Racing. You've brought on two new crew chiefs. Your son, Steven, and Brendan Gaughan have been together for 2 years in a row now. Yeah. I mean, I think this is the year that Rusty Wallace Incorporated is going to break through.
Best-looking race cars in the garage.
And coming from a championship crew chief, I'm going to listen to you.
That's a little bit of pressure there.
Good-looking race cars.
It's the old put-up-or-shut-up time there, huh?
Yeah. Well, we ain't get him to shut up, so he's putting up.
I just wanted to see if he was going to react to that.
Race car.
All right, so there is Stephen Wallace's car lined up on the grid, getting ready to go in 13th position. When NASCAR Countdown continues from Daytona, we'll talk about a word you'll hear a lot in racing: respect, something young drivers are trying to earn while they're still trying to learn.
It's needed in any kind of sport, you know, football, basketball, baseball, racing. It's all about respect.
I think you give guys respect because you know that you're going to get the same respect back.
If you don't have that respect, you know, it makes it a bear to race.
I try to race people, for the most part, how I would like to be raced. And if that person violates that in my mind, then, you know, I go a little crazy on them sometimes.
NASCAR Countdown, presented by Hellman's from Daytona International Speedway, where today the green flag flies for the opening race of the NASCAR Nationwide Series for 2010. The Nationwide Series features a mix of big-name stars and young drivers trying to make a name for themselves, a mix at a track like Daytona that can be at times somewhat volatile. To establish that name, a young driver has to earn respect, something that's easier said than done at top speed.
It's the same thing that you learned when you were 5 years old. Do unto others as you had done unto you. It's just that simple.
No matter who you are, where you are, or what you're doing, you have respect for each other, and you go out there and you treat others as you want to be treated.
With no respect, there is no.
The biggest unwritten rule is just respect of how you race and when you race. You know, that's the hardest thing to learn as you come in as a rookie.
So there's probably more giving on the Nationwide Only part, and then they do a lot of taking. So it's just how the business works. You gotta pay your dues.
A new driver can come into the Nationwide Series and race as hard as they want, but I can tell you one thing that I learned is if you make a veteran's job tough, he's gonna make yours 10 times tougher.
There's been guys that have come in and thought they were gonna rewrite how everybody races, and you know, the veterans of this series are pretty good about showing the young guys that this is how we do things, and you can try it your way, but our way's probably gonna prevail.
Everyone as a rookie driver or a new guy has an altercation with somebody.
If you want to play boys' games like that, you know, then it's every man for himself.
I jerked him by the helmet and just rattled his cage a little bit. He's just a little girl about it.
You mess with the bull, you're going to get the horns. If he wants to play those games, he's going to get hurt.
I think everyone learns some through the easy way, some through the hard way.
I've always learned the hard way. That's never going to change.
Oh, contact!
Whoa! Brad says, excuse me, pardon me, I want to play through.
Yeah, and I don't think Denny Hamlin's going to be too happy about this right here.
There's a lot of guys that owe him. There's a lot of guys that have a lot of chips that they're going to cash in. I'm just going to be the first in the pay window.
Some days it's just like, hey, I'm okay with making that guy mad. It's just the way it's going to be, and he's going to have to learn how to deal with it.
NASCAR doesn't want to step in, but they want guys to earn their way.
You think that NASCAR needs to get involved with Brad now at this point?
No, I'll take care of him. It's no biggie.
There he goes. Kowalski's around.
Whoa.
Right off the front bumper of Denny Hamlin.
That boy will never learn. He didn't do it good enough. That was fun.
Now, Denny Hamlin holds good to what he said he was going to do. He said he was going to take care of business, and right here it is.
Everybody wants to tell you that you have to earn respect, and they all want to play that card on you. And then when it comes time for you to do the right thing and for them to do the right thing back, they never do.
Be cool. And Brad's sitting over here in the studio while Aretha's playing, doing a little dance behind
the
desk. All right. Let's talk about respect. And respect on the racetrack. React to what you heard. I know. Never mind what you saw Brad dancing here.
Well, I don't know how I could describe it any better than Mark, but respect, it's like horsepower. You can never have enough, and it's hard to get, easy to lose. And as Mark said, you know, you've got to earn that by being smart as well as brave. And I will tell you, sometimes those rookies earn it off the front bumper of the veterans.
Yeah, I mean, and let's give NASCAR a lot of credit for putting some of the opportunity back into the driver's hands, the competitor's hands, to police themselves, as we've heard all month. But it'll be interesting because now those decisions have to be made of how you will react against your competitor. Will it be respectfully, or will it be taking advantage of? And that's what makes the sport great. It's competition.
Rusty, in the draft at Daytona, again, that mix of experienced stars and young drivers, how does respect play?
Alan, respect is everything in the draft. Number one, if I don't respect you, I'm not going to draft with you. I'm not even going to help you until you do something to get me to earn your respect. You know, these guys that don't have respect, they get hung out to dry in this draft. I'll tell you what, some of the guys, though, that are unrespected, that some people think, a lot of times they can fix that by before the race starts. They can go to these drivers and say, hey, look, man, I apologize for what I've done in the past. I got a pretty good car, and I need some help. Would you draft with me? And I will tell you what, those guys will remember that during the race. But without respect, hey, you're a goner, no doubt about that.
I take it Jeff Gordon never did come up and just say any of those things and earn any of your respect.
We never touched you. Let me tell you,
that was a break. You brake checked us.
Gordon caused all those problems. Hey, look, Ray, look.
You need to look at the brakes on your brakes.
Enough of that. I'm not going to go there, but I tell you one thing. You know I'm right.
I thought it was me you didn't like.
Old history. Let's talk to one of the guys in today's race. Brad Keselowski has moved himself from young upstart to now being an established driver. He starts 24th today, Jamie.
Well, he certainly was a breakout star last year. Four wins, finished third in the points. But this year, new team in Penske Racing, new crew chief, and you're doing double duty on the Cup side too. How can those changes impact your ability to win this year, Brad?
Well, hopefully it makes it easier. We've got a great team here. Brand new everything, brand new cars, brand new people. Just a great feeling, great vibe through Penske Racing. Just excited to have a discount tire and hopefully put this Dodge in victory lane.
You're one of the fastest cars on a 5-lap average on Thursday. How do you feel about your chances of getting this car to victory lane?
I feel pretty good about it. The car's, really good. Actually, Paul didn't even get a chance to build this car. We wonder if Paul would have got more time to work with it. We think it would be even better. But, it's been an awesome car. Got to thank everybody back at Penske Racing for building it. But the two biggest challengers, we think, are going to be Kevin and Tony. So we'll have to do what we can to beat them.
All right. Note to fans, Brad Keselowski is in the number 22 Dodge this year. He rolls off 24th. Alan.
All right, Jamie, thanks. We'll keep an eye on Brad K today throughout the race. Check this out. Just a moment ago on pit road, Wallace family photo.
Wow.
Four Wallaces in the race today.
I'm going to get one of those for the wall, that's for sure.
That's cool. That's very cool. Historic.
How about that? It's pretty cool, huh?
Yep.
There you go.
We need to have him in there.
Oh, no. I'm not near pretty enough like them cats are.
He's busy right now. Thank you very much. Someone who has everyone's respect in the draft at Daytona is Dale Earnhardt Jr., a three-time winner of this race. When NASCAR Countdown continues, Marty Smith talks with Jr. and asks questions about commitment to success and more. He gets some pretty frank answers.
Bar, realty company, television production company, nationwide series team. Are you spread too thin?
What right do you or anybody else have to tell me what kind of businessman to be and what kind of life really to live? What I love about Daytona,
it's nice to go somewhere with beaches where it's warm and to have the fans and the community just embrace you and kick off the season on a high note.
I like the fans being down here and, you know, it's first race of the year, so everybody's hyped up, ready to go.
I love the draft. I love the racing.
I love the size of the track. I like that it's really, really big.
What I love about Daytona is when you can see the checkered flag and your car's not tore up.
I think just winning here is the coolest thing that can happen, period, in motorsports, I think.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. knows what it's like to win at Daytona. He's enjoyed a lot of success at this track. He's won 5 Nationwide Series races and 2 Sprint Cup races, including the 2004 Daytona 500. And then the 2004 300-mile race. It kind of was unique that weekend. The Saturday race was rained out, so Junior won the 500 on Sunday and then came back on Monday, saying he might have been a little under the weather, if you get my drift, and took the 300 on that Monday as well. Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s 2009 season came nowhere close to meeting expectations. And Jr. came to Daytona looking for a fresh start and to put all of the questions of the past behind. NASCAR Now lead reporter Marty Smith sat down with Dale Jr. and asked all of those questions. In return, he got some pretty frank answers.
Describe 2009 for Dale Earnhardt Jr., the race car driver.
For the race car driver, it was really frustrating. A lot of disappointment. You would go to the racetrack every week and hope that this would be the week that it was going to turn around, something good was going to happen, it just never really worked out that way.
You actually said towards the end of the year, I'm, quote, at the end of my rope. What'd that mean?
You know, what I meant that I was at the end of my rope, meaning I didn't know what else to do, or I didn't know where else to go, or how to turn it around, or what, you know, professionally at the time, you know, it was probably the most frustrated I had ever been.
When you're struggling, how bad do you need somebody to put their arm around you? When you were going to Hendrick, that's one thing that you mentioned about Rick.
Yeah.
He's a guy that puts his arm around me and lets me know I'm a pretty good race car driver.
Yeah.
How bad do you need that?
Well, when we were running as badly as we were last year, I really didn't want to see Rick, you know, because I was just so disappointed and ashamed. We have like a conference call every Tuesday, and if I could get the guts to show up for that and...
Didn't do it all the time?
Man, you know, we run so bad sometimes, I just wanted to disappear, you know.
Jimmy Johnson, Mark Martin, Jeff Gordon, atop the sport. And then there's your team. What's it like to walk into the shop knowing that you're not living up to that standard?
It's real tough, actually, to drive up to HMS and walk through that shop, knowing what you did last week or the year before. And you just got to man up. You know, you still have a lot of guys in there, the entire company pretty much, putting together race cars that you're going to be taking to Daytona and you're going to be driving all year long. And so you have to sort of, you know, just go in there and get down to business.
It seems like that success that those guys had could go two ways with you. It could either make you say, hey, I can do that, or it could kill your confidence.
Yeah.
Because they are so good. Where were you with that? How does their performance affect your confidence?
Yeah. My confidence in my driving never really got poor. My confidence just in turning it around was always hard to put together.
There are detractors coming out of the woodwork everywhere. There are people that want to tear you down. What would you say to people that say you were exposed last year?
That I was exposed? Well, I look at exposed, you know, as what? You know,
it's not the talent that some people may think
really
you are.
Well, you know, there's a long list of statistics and trophies that I have and memories that I have that would argue against that. You know, that I got legitimate talent to drive a race car and have what it takes to win races and have what it takes to run up front. And you know, we were exposed as being a poor race team last year, and I don't think anything more than that.
Bauer, Realty Company, Television Production Company, Nationwide Series Team.
Yep.
Tons of peripheral business interests.
Sure.
Are you spread too thin?
No. What? Okay. What right do you or anybody else have to tell me what kind of businessman to be and what kind of life really to live? If I'm everybody should have an urgency to be an entrepreneur or to create whatever life they want for themselves. For the most part, we just sit back and let it go. All the things that I'm really involved in are basically laid in the hands of someone else that we feel, you know, is going to be responsible for it. And so a lot of people like to point at all those things we do and all the associations we have and partnerships we have, and a lot of people think that that's where my focus goes. But it's entirely misinterpreted and misunderstood.
Was there ever a time in the last 2 years that you thought going to Hendrick was a mistake? Because it's kind of the one place where there is no excuse.
Want to drive a B-class car or a C-class car and go, hey, man, I got an excuse for why I'm not running good.
That's what I'm saying.
That's one hell of a way to live right there. You know, a lot of people might feel like that's a good way to live their life, but that's not how I want to live my life. I want to be with the best. I want to be in the best position to have the best equipment to be able to go to the racetrack with all the confidence in the world in my and what I'm driving. If I don't turn it around and we don't get where we want to be and nothing, you know, we don't ever, you know, see the success that we wish we wanted to have, you know, we will be disappointed. And I won't ignore the fact that it was disappointing that it didn't work out, but it wasn't a mistake to go there. It wasn't a mistake to do it, even if it doesn't work. And it won't matter to me that someone thinks it was a mistake. I'll have the memories of being involved in it and having done it. That's priceless, you know?
Interesting thoughts from Dale Earnhardt Jr. behind the pre-race stage, getting ready to be introduced. Today he starts in the third position in the number 88 car. As you listen to that, Brad, what was your reaction?
For me, the big thing is I think last year was as low as it possibly could get for Dale Earnhardt Jr. I think the disappointment was overwhelming to a point because he ran so poorly. So I think that's all behind him. I think the big thing that we've got to watch for, and maybe the most apparent thing, is the emotional baggage that's come with all of this. The media continually to bear down on him, and the weight, it's got to be crushing. So I don't know if he can handle it mentally, because it's all right here, it seems like, to me right now.
What do you think?
Well, look, he is very aware that everybody's looking at him, everybody's critiquing him and trying to get him in victory lane. I mean, he's thought about it a lot. You know, I talked to him. He says he is all in. He's focused. He's doing everything he possibly can. And he really thinks that he can turn this year around this year. I mean, this guy's a great competitor. I know he can get the job done. He's just got to do it. But when you really get down to it, I mean, all drivers really, when you talk to them, they say, Rusty, I just can't get my car to handle right. If your car doesn't handle right, you look terrible. He has just got to figure a way, him and that crew chief, to get these four tires to stick to the ground so these cars handle right so this cat can run up front, because he can definitely run up front and he can win the Daytona 500 and he can make the chase.
Well, and in fairness to Dale Jr., there are other drivers who have many, many outside business interests. Jeff Gordon, Tony Stewart, you put them to the right people and they handle them for you, as Dale was saying. You know, I do, however, believe that this is a young man who's got a tremendous amount of talent, and he's got good equipment now. And I do think that the responsibility of the focus of getting that chemistry back in that team, he's such a huge personality that if he leads, people will follow. But I think he takes a lot of heat for being distracted with business interests, and I don't think that's the problem.
No,
I really agree with Rusty, and it's just communication on getting him what he needs in a race car.
A win today. I know his big focus, his bread and butter, is that Sprint Cup ride. And by the way, he starts second in the Daytona 500. So win today, do anything to help over there?
Well, I think it gives him some confidence. And the thing is, today he gets to race and there's not all of the pressure. I mean, we almost forget about him sometimes when he gets into these nationwide races because he does so well. Plus, there's the Danica effect today. So he gets to hide and have fun, and I bet you he does a darn good job because of that.
Oh, let me tell you one thing. If this cat wins today, the morale goes sky high, not only in his own team that he owns, but also in all the members that are surrounding him. Look, he loves his team that he owns, and his cup guys are going to be sky high. Yeah. And you know what? If that does happen, it's going to silence all us guys.
A win is a win.
Our mouth will be shut after that.
Especially at Daytona. Prospects today, very good for Junior, starting third. Our J-Ski news and notes now. The green-white checker procedure NASCAR uses to try and ensure a green flag finish for fans was adjusted a bit this week. Instead of just one attempt at finishing the race under the green, NASCAR is now going to make up to three attempts at a green flag finish. But if the leader's taken the white flag and then the caution flag flies, that's it. The race is over at the instant the yellow waves. A lot of folks think there's a good chance we'll have at least one attempt at a green-white checker finish here today.
Very high probability of that, and I absolutely love it. I think it's a great idea because it gives the fans the maximum opportunity to see a great finish, and plus they're doing it through all three of the major series for to be equal. I like that uniform.
Where am I running? If I'm running 10th, I like it. If I'm running first, I don't like it. It's just a matter of where you're running.
Yeah.
Now, look, guys, I'm going to tell you, I'll be frank with you. I hate this rule. When I was driving and they had these things that always caused a pile of wrecks, fans are going to love the excitement, no doubt about that. As a driver, I hate the wrecks, so I hate this rule. We'll see what happens.
We will see what happens, and we will see what happens when driver introductions begin here at Daytona International Speedway. What kind of reception will the NASCAR fans give Danica Patrick? Closing in on the green flag, you're watching NASCAR Countdown, presented by Hellman's from Daytona International Speedway.
Starting 15th, the number 7, GoDaddy Chevrolet. From Roscoe, Illinois, Danica Patrick.
Danica Patrick being introduced just a moment ago. Let's see, Jim Belushi, Bruce Jenner, Patty Lovelace, and Patty Michael Strahan.
That's right.
Those folks she's well familiar with because Danica also is one of the celebrity spokespeople for that Drive4COPD campaign and just introduced on the stage a minute ago. While today is really about a chance to win at Daytona for every driver, a quick look at the Cup drivers who are going to run all the Nationwide Series races and compete for the championship this year. Carl Edwards, Brad Keselowski, and Paul Menard committed to run all the races and compete for the title as well as all the Sprint Cup races. Kevin Harvick, he's kind of teasing us. He says he's going to run them all through May and then kind of see where things stack up and reevaluate.
He'll run them all.
We'll see what happens with the happy Harvick. We hope this season begins as spectacularly as last season ended for the Nationwide Series. Remember back at Homestead Miami Speedway, Carl Edwards tried to chase down Kyle Edwards in the last laps and steal the win away.
Oh, man, they were bumper to bumper through those closing laps side by side throughout that race, matter of fact. Look at Carl getting sideways, but Kyle gets it done.
Kyle took the race win and the championship trophy to close that season. He starts on the pole today with Edwards alongside. Let's hear from both, beginning with Dave.
About something a little different for Kyle this year rolling into Daytona. He comes in as the reigning champion. Did it feel any different walking in here this year?
Not really, but you know, we're excited about that. And it's my first Speedway pole ever, I think, and due to that was being a champion last year. So means something, and I'm glad we were able to get that today. It just means we get to start further up front and hopefully stay out of trouble if anything happens early in a race. But we've got a great Interstate Batteries Camry. You know, we're looking forward to today's race. We feel like we've got a good shot at it. We know the Chevrolets are strong with their different engine rules and stuff, so you know, we'll battle through it and see what we can get.
What's your biggest asset today? Horsepower, you kind of mentioned, may not be the one. What's the biggest asset for the 18?
Well, I feel like we always handle really well. You know, the car always seems to drive good. It seems to stay under me pretty well. So if we can have that same thing here today where we can run the longest on the bottom wide open, then, you know, we'll be pretty good.
The champ starts first today.
All right, David, thank you. I said we'll hear from Kyle and Carl. Carl just got pulled up to be introduced to the crowd, so yeah. We'll get back to Carl Edwards in just a minute. All right, our Hellman's recipe for success now. Guys, I picked these three items out to put in my recipe for success at Daytona. Tell me what you think of them.
Well, first of all, I think you did a good job.
I
mean, look at
that
flat-footed handling. I'm telling you one thing. If you can run around this racetrack all day long on the metal, wide open, you got a great handle of race car, because we all know that hardly anybody else can do that. If you can pull it off, you'll probably win.
Yeah, I think patience pays off, though, Rusty, as we go throughout the day. I think the guy with the cool head at the end of the day will have a great opportunity to win this race. Don't put yourself in bad positions. Stay in line. Figure out what you got. Tune on that hot rod and go get you a checkered flag.
And we're winning 4 of the last 5 races here, and based on what we saw in practice the other day, I'm going to stick with the smoke and ride with him.
Yeah, if you're somewhere near Tony Stewart by the end of this race, you'll probably be somewhere near the front of the pack. I think that's a pretty good bet. Look at that flag. Man. The wind is blowing today. It's a chilly day for Florida, and we'll talk about how that will affect the cars and the drivers and the pit crews after we hear from Carl Edwards. Vince has caught up with
him. You going to go with me in the truck?
Yeah, with Carl real quick, and then we're going to hop on the truck in the process, so this will be coordinated. We'll see how that works. 13 laps of practice is all you did today, or all you did this week. You skipped the second practice altogether. Right. What should Carl Edwards fans think about that in regards to how you feel about your car?
They should have a lot of confidence. I mean, this Fastenal Copart Ford Fusion is good. Mike Kelly and the guys have been working very hard. The guys in the engine department have been working hard. When I pulled out for the first couple laps of practice, that's the best nationwide car I've had. You know, the most powerful, fastest car I've had. All right, Kyle's not stealing my Ford. I got a really pretty Ford F-150 for me here, but just really excited about this car, this race, ready to get the season started. And I got to say hi to Dwight Laxton back at home. He's not doing so well. He's one of my car owners that helped me get to this point, and we wish you luck, Dwight.
You've won 25 times in this series, but never here at Daytona. How would a win at Daytona be different?
Be huge. I mean, it's Daytona. I mean, look around. Look at all these people. It'd mean the world to win here at Daytona, so we got to start this championship run right, and this will be the place to do it.
Thanks, Carl. He was runner-up in this race a year ago in the closest nationwide Daytona finish ever. Carl Edwards goes off second today, Alan.
A talent-packed field to go 300 miles at Daytona International Speedway today. Tony Stewart among those we look to talk to when we come back to the World Center of Racing.
NASCAR Countdown is presented by the mayonnaise that's real and delicious, Hellman's, and in part by Ink, the new business card from Chase. Make your mark with Ink.
Right there, baby.
Aerial coverage brought to you by DirecTV. DirecTV, it'll change your life. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. When the checkered flag waved on this race the last 2 years, the same man was the first one under it, Tony Stewart. Last year, he drove a Hendrick Motorsports Chevrolet, car number 80, and had to hold off a furious charge in the final corners from Kyle Busch.
Well, I mean, this was just a heck of a race as Kyle gave him a little bit of a nudge as they go off down in the corner. You thought Tony was going to actually lose it. Look at that car dancing around. Look at his hands bouncing around. Great job by a guy who is probably the best at this racetrack.
Stewart will start 32nd today in pursuit of another Daytona win, Doc.
Well, Tony, they said Dale Earnhardt Sr. had it. He won here 7 times, and you and Junior both have it. You've combined to win 9 times. What does it take to win here so many times?
Well, you got to be with good teams, and I'm with another good one this year. I got the honor to drive for Rick Hendrick last year and win with him, and, I've won with these guys, with Kevin and Delana Harvick, and it's pretty cool. I mean, this Oreo Ritz Crackers Chevy is fast. It was really fast in practice, and, the biggest thing is just taking care of it. You got 300 miles to go, and, 120 laps doesn't sound like a lot of laps, but it is here at Daytona, so it's just taking care of your car, working on it, and making sure you don't beat it up to where at the end of the day when it's time to go hard and time to run for the money that you've got a piece that's nice and straight and clean and you've worked on it and just made the right adjustments all day. So, Butch Hilton's pretty sharp and on top of it. So I think we're going to have a pretty good day.
Good luck to you.
Thanks, buddy.
Alan, look for Tony Stewart from 32nd to come out swinging when they wave the green.
I'll bet that's going to be a lot of fun to watch, Doc. Thanks very much. And let's talk about what to watch for as this 300 miles unfolds here today at Daytona. Ray, first topic for you is problems in the pits.
Yeah, I'm going to be in the pits, so I'm going to be watching pit road. Big track, narrow pit road, get slick. We always have trouble here with tires rolling across, cars making contact. Seems like every year one of our lead cars gets taken out on pit road.
And as for Mr. Wallace, he wants to talk about the big pack and the big wreck.
Oh, it's going to be tied out today. I know I've been here many, many times at Daytona. I will tell you, this is probably the strongest field I've ever seen here at Daytona. 6 former Daytona winners, 8 former champs, but they're going to be running very, very tight. And because of that, I think you're going to see that. A lot of wrecks. It's really cool here in Daytona. The temperatures are down. They're going to have a lot of grip. That means their cars are going to run side by side. And when that happens here at Daytona, that happens. A wreck.
What you watching for?
Well, for those of you all returning from the Greenland ice cap, Danica Patrick is in this race today. And it's going to be interesting to chronicle her throughout the day as she runs in these packs. Will she be able to keep up, keep that car nice and straight like we heard Smoke talking about, and get a good finish?
I'll tell you what, she's been smart all week long.
Yes,
she's proved me wrong every every single day. Just like Ray said, she debriefs with her team good. She hasn't wrecked her car yet in practice. She's got a lot of, you know, understanding to do yet, because this race, this is the real test. 43 cars instead of the half of the fields she's been accustomed to.
Yeah, but Ray said you was wrong when you run over them back in the day, too, when you wrecked Jeff Gordon all those times.
I could be wrong.
She's going to earn some respect today, because I think she's smart enough to stay in line and just try and go for that top 15, top 20, not make any mistakes and get some experience.
You touched on the cold a little bit ago. I want to know how the cold is going to affect the cars, the drivers, and the race we're going to see.
I really think the cold is just going to make the cars handle that much better, Alan. And when the cars handle good, they run closer together, and people turn into daredevils when her car handles real good, and that's when you start having problems.
And Alan, I'm going to go back to pit road and tell you that the guys that are standing out there, you know, you make a lot less pit stops in a nationwide race than you do in the Cup race, and these guys are going to have to stay loose. So, you know, the cold is going to make it a little bit harder for them to get over the wall and be agile.
And what we saw the other day, especially on the back stretch, was those wind gusts of up to 15, 20 miles an hour, adding tremendous speed to these cars as they enter into turn three. Guys having to get out of the throttle and burp it just a little bit. That screws up the closing rate, so we could see a lot of action as we go down to turn three.
And you're seeing pictures of some of the talent that's in this field today. You know, Kevin Harvick and Brian Vickers and Tony Stewart and Kyle Busch and so on. You got a pick? From what you've seen in practice and qualifying?
Know,
well, actually, there was no qualifying. What you've seen in practice?
I'm going to be straight up with you. I do not have a pick. I don't. There is so much talent in this field. This race could be more exciting than the Daytona 500. It's just stacked that good full of fast race cars. And these cars got a lot of downforce. Like I said, they're going to handle good, which is going to make for a whale of a race.
I'm taking Tony Stewart, Kevin Harvick, Junebug, and Kyle Busch.
That's all you want?
Half the field?
And I'm going to take Carl Edwards, too. So let's get it on. What you got?
Well, I'm going to go with Rusty and not take a pick, because you picked them all. But I will tell you, you'll see a veteran in victory lane, but you'll see a surprise good run from a rookie today.
Oh, man, I like
somebody,
that.
Somebody going to make a name at Daytona for himself today. Maybe get some respect.
I'm picking up when you're laying down, baby.
So Danica Patrick getting ready to go in her NASCAR debut at Daytona. You see, we're closing in on the green flag. We'll come back in just a minute as we get ready to go racing. The Daytona International Speedway. To a NASCAR racer, as special as Augusta National is to a golfer, as Wimbledon would be to a tennis player. Today, 43 drivers take on these high banks where so much racing history has been written. A little more history to be written today. And all those drivers hoping to be the one to grab the place in the record books as the winner at Daytona today. Pretty cool day by Florida standards. Temperatures in the mid-50s. There's been a pretty good wind blowing. The sun has at least come out to warm some of these fans, and that's a good thing. And I think the big packs of cars with the drafting racing we see here. Let's go trackside for the opening ceremony.
Ladies and gentlemen, please rise and remove your hats as the Mainland High School Air Force Junior ROTC Color Guard presents our nation's colors. Please remain standing as Reverend Sonny Gallman of Central Baptist Church of Daytona Beach offers today's invocation.
Let us pray. Loving God, we know that every good gift in our lives is a blessing from you. And so we thank you for this day where we can be with one another and where we can enjoy each other's company. We ask that you would keep the drivers and their crews safe. And we make one more request. Keep the track dry and let the cars fly. Amen.
Here to perform our national anthem, please welcome epic recording artist Videra, Kristen May.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming? Whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watch, were so gallantly streaming. Still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet
building now. The tension, the excitement as the green flag draws closer. A lot of fantastic finishes and thrilling racing in the Speed Week's event so far. How will this 300 miles unfold at Daytona International Speedway?
These days, the world moves pretty fast, but some of us move even faster. For us, speed is the calling, and Daytona is the race.
It's time to rock and roll. 1, 2, 3, two.
Hey, cars off. Be ready.
Optimism and energy every driver feels when he comes to Daytona for the beginning of a new season. Those drivers have been thinking about this race and this place for 3 months through the offseason. Now it's time to stop talking about it, stop thinking about it, buckle in and go racing. Rusty, you've been there before on the grid at Daytona. What's this moment like as a driver buckles in for that first race of the year?
No, right now it's the best time. The interviews are over, the distractions are done. You're done talking to family and friends. It's time to rock and roll and just race, man. That's what they've been waiting for. Get them out of the way, let's go.
Yeah, as an owner, and every time I've been down with my driver, you're always trying to get them to focus on what they're doing, but not suck the energy out of them. You're getting ready for this big event, but you don't want to be exasperated before the flag even falls. Relax and focus. And
those crew chiefs are going, get those photographers out of my pits. Let's go.
All right, so the safety equipment being attached to the window net will go up. The radios will be tested, and those crewmen will have to step away from the car now as we're going trackside for the command to start engines and get the 2010 NASCAR Nationwide Series season underway.
They are kicking off Drive4COPD with a cross-country race you can follow online at drive4copd.com. Here to give those most famous words in motorsports, please welcome co-grand marshals, Emmy-nominated actor Jim Belushi, Olympic gold medalist Bruce Jenner, Grammy Award-winning country music star Patti Loveless, and pro football great Michael Strahan.
Gentlemen, start your engines!
When that heat going right up.
Got me, bud?
Good.
Yes, sir.
Hey. Yeah, 10-4, buddy. Just to let you know, you're about 10 away right where you sit.
All right, on a chilly day, might be an extra minute or so for the engines to warm before the cars roll off the pit lane. But as the field gets ready to go, let's us roll upstairs to three men who've been there and done that when it comes to big races. Dale Jarrett, Andy Petrie, and Marty Reed set to call today's race. Gentlemen, all yours.
All right, thank you, Alan. Hello, everybody. And you guys did a great job of setting the scene for us, especially the number of stars we have. 15 double-duty drivers. Five of them have Nationwide Series wins here at Daytona. But in the 28 years we've run this race, two drivers were non-Sprint Cup winners, and that was Chad Little. He did it once. Our own Randy LaJoie did it three times. Every other time, it's been a Sprint Cup regular that's won this race. race. Let's talk about the guys who might break through today and become that third driver.
Somebody that's looked real good the whole week here has been Trevor Bayne, 18 years old. He's out there doing a great job driving that car to the front. He's led a lot of the groups I've seen out there, so he could be a guy that could break through and get a win. And Stephen Wallace, every time we've talked to him, he's been so confident. He's changed to Toyotas this year, and it could be his first win.
Andy, I picked up on a couple of other drivers. Michael Annette, who really had a good run here last year in both the races at Daytona, I think has a great shot at showing what he can do out here today, possibly even winning this race. And the other would be Colin Brown. He's in good equipment from Roush Fenway. I really think that he's going to show us the talents that he has. It'll be fun watching their progress here today.
Well, and as you have heard everybody talking about all weekend long through the practice sessions, it has been the number four of Tony Stewart that has been the class of the field. And Tony is going to be our in-race reporter. In fact, he's ready to go. Let's give it to DJ and let's talk to him.
Hey, Tony, Dale Jarrett, ESPN. You have a copy?
Yeah, bud.
Hey, Smoke, our first question is from our ESPN mailbag, and Cora from Pilot Mountain, North Carolina asks, you look great in practice this week. What gives you so much confidence racing at Daytona?
Yeah, I wish I knew. It's just, part of it's having good cars. I got the honor to win with Rick Hendrick last year here and HendrickCars.com, and today we're in the Oreo Ritz Cracker Chevy with Kevin and Delena, and that's where I got my first win, was with Kevin and Delena. So every time I run for these guys and everybody at KHI, they always give us great race cars. So that's three quarters of the battle right there. When you got a good car, and you know you got a good car when you get it, gives you that confidence.
Smoke, we have a lot of rookies and first-timers in this field today. You're back there in 32nd. Have you taken the opportunity to kind of familiarize yourself with who's in what car? Are you really not concerned? You're just going to pass them as you get to them?
Well, the hard part is I only know about five guys off of their numbers, so you're right. I mean, there's a lot of people that I don't know, and even guys that are veterans in this series, I don't know what cars they're in. So the biggest thing, just kind of evaluate the situation as it comes, and 120 laps here is still a long, long race, even though it's only 300 miles. And it's kind of self-preservation for the most part. You just got to take care of it and make sure that for the first 100 laps, don't put a scratch on this thing to where, get this Oreo Ritz Crackers car there at the end.
All right, Smoke, thanks for talking with us. Have a great day. And now Andy's going to talk to your crew chief, Butch Hilton.
All right, buddy.
Hey, Butch Hilton, Andy Petrie, you got us?
Yes, sir. Andy, I got you loud and clear.
Hey, Butch, you know this racetrack right here can get real greasy and slick and be a real handling race. You get six sets of tires. How many do you have left, and how do you plan to use them?
Well, we just used one set up, and we got a set of mock qualifiers that are scuffed, and we'll put them to the back of the line, and we'll try to save a set to the end. That seems to be the best way to go here.
Okay, Butch, we appreciate it. Good luck today. Thanks for talking to us.
Yes, sir.
Obviously, a little audio bleed on their frequency, but I don't think it'll bother Tony, because I think he's going to focus on one thing. All he wants to hear is clear and move to the front. All right, as you look from high above, a good sized crowd making their way to their seats as the cars begin to roll out. The electricity continues to build at Daytona. Cars on the first of three pace laps here at Daytona International Speedway. Our starting grid will come across the top of the screen. We have a couple of history makers today. Two women in the field, Chrissy Wallace, and of course, that girl in the seven car. And four Wallace family members. The last time that happened was, back in 1949. Tim Infante and Bob Flock raced with their sister, Ethel Mobley. All right, let's check the onboards. We've got a bunch for you. Tony Stewart, Kevin Harvick, Stephen Wallace, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Trevor Bayne, Mike Bliss, Justin Allgaier, and of course, Danica Patrick. Let's get the latest from pit road. First up, Vince Welch.
Well, Marty, we've talked so much about Danica Patrick's performance in the draft during this course of practice during this week, but equally important today is her performance on pit road. She has never driven a car in a race like she's going to drive here today, and for that reason, this experience is going to be completely different. During her test sessions, her and the team have practiced pit stops over and over. They know a great day in the draft can be ruined if they don't execute here in the pit box. And for more on that, let's check in with Tim Brewer. Tim?
Vince, you're exactly right. When Danica comes down pit road in an Indy car, she hadn't got any roll bars, hadn't got anything obscuring her vision. But this one of these situations today, she's really going to have to rely on the pit spotter and her crew to counter in, because she's got no room to move in, no side vision whatsoever. So getting in and out of the pit areas without tearing the fenders up is going to be very important. Now down to Hollywood, what's going on pit road?
Thanks, Tim. Danica Patrick has asked a lot of questions all week long on the racetrack, but today she'll be asking a lot of questions before a pit stop and after a pit stop. She has to trust the decisions being made up on the box and the crew going over the wall. Her first pit stop today will be the first in a Nationwide Series car. So guys, it's going to be exciting, and it's just a part of the learning curve for Dana Patrick here at Daytona.
All right, thanks, Hollywood. And we make it sound like it, you know, this should be a simple process. Let's go back to the duels. Ask AJ Allmendinger.
Yeah, exactly. These pit boxes are really slick. They had a 24-hour race here just a couple weeks ago, and even though we had a lot of rain, there's still a lot of fluids left down from that. So she really needs to be careful in doing that. You know, you really can't win the race, and she's not here to definitely win, but you could certainly ruin your day if you don't take care of your car and get in and out of pits properly.
And like Hollywood said, it's up to the crew chief and that spotter to keep her out of trouble. Some of that stuff she can't see. She's going to have to rely on them. They have to do a good job of watching out for her, giving her good information to make sure they don't step on each other on the radio.
Let's get some last-minute updates from pit road. Doc, you're up.
Thanks, guys. You know, two-time champion Kevin Harvick is still undecided as to whether he will run the full season for the championship again. The key factor, one word, fun. He said, if I'm having fun and we're doing well here on pit road, I may decide to go ahead and run the entire year to get that third title. Right now, his plans are to run every race up and through the end of May at Charlotte. However, if he runs very well today, he may make a quick decision and go ahead and opt to run the entire year. Dave.
Doc, if you know Dale Earnhardt Jr., you know he's all about throwback, all about old school. And so one of the things that's most important to him today is he's back together with his old crew chief, Pops Urey. Pops is on the pit box today for the first time in 5 years with Dale Earnhardt Jr. Now remember, it wasn't Pops that changed. Jr. is a driver for this race after Keselowski ran this car last year. And this reuniting after 5 years could breed very good things for this team here at Daytona. Jamie?
Well, Carl Edwards has done very many things in the Nationwide Series, but one thing he is missing, a coveted win here at Daytona. He came so close last year, finishing second to Tony Stewart. But hey, today could be the day. He's starting outside front row, and he told us this is the fastest he has ever felt in a Nationwide car here at Daytona. Marty?
All right, thanks, team. As we get ready to go green here, one car that is in the garage area, and it's bad news for fans of 68-year-old Morgan Shepherd, the oldest man in the field. They have a throttle linkage problem. They pulled it right behind the wall as he tried to get out of pit road.
Yeah, that's unfortunate for Morgan. He made the field. They didn't have to qualify, but they made it in, and now he's sitting in the garage area. But it looks like the back of the car jacked up as well.
See if he can get out. The pace lights are out, and that means we'll be going green next time by. It was exactly 28 years ago today, the first ever Nationwide Series event was held right here on the 2.5-mile oval. Let's listen in on Brad Keselowski's radio. We hear he may have a problem.
Playing around here with the transmission fault, something in the linkage ain't right. I can't really tell, but when I go into second, it's like it tries to keep going after it's already in gear. Same thing in fourth. Maybe the adjuster is backed way up or something. I'm not really sure. I'll pay attention to it and let you know.
Okay, so it sounds like Brad's got shift linkage problems and you're shaking your head.
Yeah, that's not going to get better as the race goes on. I don't know exactly what kind of transmission and linkage system they have. A lot of them run different ones. But I don't like the sound of that. Sounds like third and fourth gate has a problem.
Yeah, you know, you come here, this first race, you're so excited about it and, you know, the anticipation of trying to win here. But these teams have worked hard to get prepared and just sometimes the small details. And, you know, they haven't had a tremendous amount of time on the racetrack and haven't been on the track since Thursday.
You saw Paul Wolf and the team trying to sort things out. We'll follow that story, as well as Smoke running his way back from the 32nd spot. He gets into the race, courtesy of being a winner from last year, as did Greg Biffle. $2.735 million. It's a record purse for this race. But That's not what the 43 drivers are hoping for. They want to hold on to that trophy. It's been 84 days since our last race. If you need your fix for speed, we're about to go green.
Proud of you this whole week, actually the last 2 weeks here. Done a nice job. All the guys did a nice job too, Tony. Nice to be a part of you guys here.
Right on. Thanks, guys. Let's finish strong.
Butterflies in her stomach have to be the size of a 747 right now. You're at Daytona for your first start. The Ford Mustang pace car brings them out of turn number four. All the fans here, and look at the size of this crowd, bigger than last year, without a doubt. Pace car pulls off. Here comes the field. Kyle Busch down on the low side. Carl Edwards right up beside him. And the 2010 NASCAR Nationwide season is green. Everybody looks good coming through turns one and two down the backstretch for lap number one.
Yeah, pretty interesting. Kyle Busch decided to jump up in that high line from starting down on the inside.
Yeah, he got a good start, so he was able to kind of choose which lane he could go in, and he chose that outside lane down the backstretch. You got to think they're going to run the bottom of the racetrack if they get single file, but that upper lane looked pretty good there for the first lap.
Coming out of turn number four, Kyle Busch followed by Carl Edwards. Kevin Harvick is in third. Oh, we've got a crash coming down out of turn number four. The 41 car of Chrissy Wallace, making her Nationwide Series debut, has hit the wall hard. Two other cars had to go down pit road. There's another car spinning as a result, Brad Teague.
Yeah, he went sliding down through the infield grass. Chrissy Wallace looks like she has the most damage.
Window net down means that Chrissy is A-OK, but the car is definitely not. There's Brad. Brad, the second oldest driver in this field at age 62. He gets it back out. He's got damage to that left front you can see right there. It looks like it was a separate incident because that was much further down on the racetrack.
But Brad, just his momentum carried him down through the grass. He was trying to avoid this. Looks like some cars got together right there towards the back of that pack.
And there's Chrissy climbing out, and I'm sure she's not thrilled at all with the way this ended up.
It looks like Chrissy gets loose, real loose right there, and just overcorrects, gets into the outside wall.
Yeah, she had a car right on her bumper. Looked like Paul Menard, who was right on her bumper. That'll really free you up. And in her defense, she hasn't had a lot of time this week. They had some problems getting the car through inspection, and then she didn't get a lot of time either day with the car, and especially in race trim.
And the laps we saw, her run, that car was out of control. Looks like it's not much better here. I mean, she just really got loose off turn four. Those bumps are really, really upset the car when you're on the bottom.
Yeah, and we should point out, it wasn't Chrissy out of control. The car just looked evil.
Yeah, the car just, every time we saw it, it looked like it wanted to go, that is out of mind of its own.
Well, looks like it had a mind of its own right there. As Chrissy Wallace is our first victim on the racetrack, we'll take a break and come back to Daytona. Under our first caution here in the drive for COPD 300 at Daytona International Speedway, as we can tell you that Brad Teague has taken his car to the garage area. Morgan Shepherd, though, is back out. He's two laps down, but Morgan's crew got the car fixed, so he's back in. Checking back through the field, Kevin Harvick, we mentioned, third behind Edwards and Busch. Logano fourth, Earnhardt Jr. in fifth. And his team car, Danica Patrick, as he has been mentoring her throughout the weekend, giving her as much advice as he possibly could. She has dropped back from her 15th starting position to 18th. And this was not surprising. The crew had said that Tony Urie was going to say, look, just take it easy. If you fall back, it's okay.
Yeah, and these starts and restarts are going to be probably the most exciting times that she's going to see, and the things that she hasn't had to really deal with. So getting used to that, and as she gets one or two under these belts, she'll understand a little bit more of it. Vince?
Well, the main objective for Danica Patrick here is they want to keep her on the bottom of the racetrack. They feel like the trouble is going to be up top. And they said as long as she's comfortable running where she's at, they won't drop to the back. But if she starts feeling uncomfortable, you maybe see her slip back out of some of the heavier traffic. But the main objective, stay on the bottom of the racetrack. Just before they went green, by the way, Dale Jr. came on the radio to her and said, have fun and trust your instincts. So far, Danica said after one lap, albeit one lap, she said, hey, that was pretty good. Liked it. So we'll keep our eye on it for sure.
All right. Thanks for the update, Vince. To check in with Tony Stewart, our in-race reporter, he's moved up from 32nd to 29th.
Hey, Smoke DJ, you have a copy?
Yeah, bud.
Hey, man, you were practicing your cup car this morning. Now you're in this car. Haven't been in it since Thursday. Is that a big adjustment on your part?
Not really. I mean, you kind of remember, you know, just from last year, the package for these cars really hasn't changed. So, you know, just a little bit of riding around you do on the three pace laps kind of gets you back to what you're doing and, you know, up to speed. You're like no.
All right, man. Be careful. Talk to you later.
And remember, the heavy rains yesterday washed off all the rubber that we had built up, and only the practice earlier today by Sprint Cup were for tomorrow's 500. That's the only rubber that is down on the track right now. We can give you an update. Chrissy Wallace has been released from the infield medical center, and that is good news. Dave, what's the update on the 22 on Brad Keselowski?
Yeah, Marty, I wanted to check with Paul Wolf, the crew chief, and find out if there was any issue with the transmission. Seemed like he got up through the gears that first time. Okay, Paul.
Yeah, he said everything felt fine. Wasn't sure under caution or what was wrong. Something in the linkage didn't feel just right, but said it shifted fine up through the gears. So I don't expect there to be a problem the rest of the day.
All right, that's good news from the 22 pit. Doc?
Chrissy Wallace has walked out of the care center. First of all, Chrissy, you okay?
Yeah, I'm perfectly fine. Car is not, so...
What happened?
98. He's just racing too hard, too early. It was a dumb mistake on his part, and unfortunately, we got taken out.
When will we see you again?
Hopefully in the next couple of weeks. We're hoping so, trying to work on some sponsor stuff. So if we get some sponsors, we'll be back soon.
Okay, a tough day and a short day for Chrissy Wallace, guys.
And the 98, of course, she's referring to as Paul Menard. He started shotgun on this field in 43rd. He has moved up seven spots, more than anybody else, and he is currently listed in 36. Kyle Busch, again on point. He has again decided to take the low line. Carl Edwards right alongside. We're back to green flag racing here at Daytona. Interesting. Last time on the start, Kyle went high. This time he stays low.
That's because he's got a partner there in Kevin Harvick, and he knows Harvick's car is pretty fast, so he wants to do that. You know, Kyle kind of alluded to the fact that maybe they were down a little bit horsepower-wise with these Toyotas. It sure doesn't look like it on these starts.
I didn't see it right there. It looked to me like that's a good gauge of power on these restarts, and that 18 car looked like it had plenty. Look at Carl. Oh, man, he is all over Harvick.
Man, Harvick slides up right in front of him because...
Oh, look at this.
Oh, man, that was close.
Holy cow, look at Harvick.
Hey, guys, we're only working lap number six here.
Oh, man, I'm telling you, that was tight right there. We're talking a matter of fractions of an inch.
Yeah, you saw right there exactly what makes these guys so good. That wasn't a spotter telling them clear. That's just pure instinct on Kevin Harvick's part to drive that car through there.
It's two abreast through turn two. Everybody, oh, we got crash up in the corner. The 99 of Trevor Bayne. A couple of other cars are spinning in this.
Brian Keselowski.
The 26, you're right, Keselowski in it as well, but boy, Bayne got the worst of this
one. Oh, man, his car is destroyed.
We'll have to see the replay, but I think I saw Danica Patrick make a great move to avoid being a part of that.
Well, maybe we ought to get that onboard shot. Oh, and the 40 car, Mike Bliss, is he's also caught up in this crash. Get that onboard shot of Danica. Her eyes may be as big as saucers right now. There's the damage on the right side. Window net down for Trevor, and there's the onboard view. And what a tough break. He was with us during our rain delay show yesterday when qualifying got washed out for 18 years old, the youngest in the field. So well-spoken and so composed.
Yeah, he was did such a good job in practice of staying out of trouble. Like he got some help from Mike Bliss right here.
Yeah, it doesn't matter how much talent you have. You get the rear wheels lifted off the ground, then nobody can drive.
And let's see Danica go right by there. like Stewart may have snuck through there as well.
Several other cars sneaking through on the bottom there. Take a look. Yep, you're right. He did get help.
Man, that's a hard lick, too. See, Danica gets into the back of the back of a car right there. Can't see the number.
Oh, nice job. I mean, you see a lot of these other guys, you could see the tires, smoke from them, locking up the wheels.
Speaking of smoke, look at him drive right through here in the four car.
Really a good job. I know this racetrack looks wide, but I promise you folks, that whenever something happens like that, you run out of racing room in a hurry. That was a good job by a lot of people coming through there, not making this bigger than what it could have been.
That's still a tough break for Trevor Bayne. He had such a good car.
All right, let's listen on the radio.
No, I don't know how I didn't, but I didn't.
Yeah. I don't know how I didn't, but I didn't.
Sometimes it's just a higher power, and you're glad that it's there.
Still two wide, one's got the final close. Keep coming, keep coming.
That was the view from Mike Bliss's car.
Yeah, I don't know if Trevor Bayne was having to be out of the throttle a little bit, but Mike Bliss got on me and just wouldn't lift off.
Oh, you're good there inside.
Well, there's a point right there where he's touching him, and he has to back up the gas because he's getting sideways.
You know, we've heard all of this talk about NASCAR saying, all right, guys, you know, we're going to put it in your hands, but you still have to be smart about it, and in the corners is not a place that you buck from.
Now, here's Danica's view.
Little brake check, little spin up here. Come on down, come on down, come on down, come on down.
Great job.
Clear up, caution's out. Caution's out here, caution's out.
All right. Well, unfortunately, not only are two cars out, but two of our onboard cameras. We're on those cars with the 40 of Bliss and the 99 of Bayne. We'll find out if Bliss can get back out there. We do have some cars taking advantage of this. They're running further back in the pack. There you can see the 16 of Colin Brown as he'll come in, as is also the 81 of Michael McDowell and Paul Menard as well. While these guys take a pit stop, we'll take a pit stop here at Daytona International Speedway, the world center of racing. Let's check our sports calendar for you because, they're going to be pounding the pavement out of Pomona. Qualifying from the Winter Nationals 11 Eastern tonight, and then the finals 8 Eastern, both on ESPN2. NASCAR now at 9 a.m. Eastern tomorrow and 5 o'clock Eastern Monday, again on ESPN2. And NASCAR Nationwide Series action, our next stop next Saturday from California at Fontana, 5 Eastern, all of it on ESPN2. And if you weren't aware, the Truck Series opener was rained out last night. They're going to start at 7 o'clock over on Speed. We wish Rick Allen and Phil Parsons and their crew a great season. And Morgan Shepherd gets the Aaron's Lucky Dog, so that puts him now one lap down in 39th as Bliss is off, Bayne is off after the crashes, so with Teague and Chrissy Wallace. Rusty, you said in the pre-race this was going to happen. You were right.
Well, right now there's just a lot of anxious drivers out there. This is the first race. The skies have cleared now. We've got cool temperatures. Everybody wants to win this 300, no doubt about that. But these drivers just need to calm down. I mean, some of the stuff that happened early, Paul Menard, Mike Bliss, I think they could have avoided those accidents, but it didn't happen. But, guys, I'll tell you one thing I'm worried about right now is some of the stacking up on the restarts. I've seen many races, even in the closing laps of the Daytona 500, three and four laps to go, they wrecked the whole field at the start-finish line. These guys got to be calm on the restarts, and I know that DJ knows all about that one.
Yeah, you want to get going, and you want to get up there and try to help the guy in front of you, but you just, as you said, Rush, you have to calm down. I know there's a lot of guys that have a lot of anxious moments right now because it is the first race. It's a huge race, but you just have to be calm.
Paul Menard stops in again to top off. Remember, he started at the back of the field. There is Tony Raines' car. A lot of damage there. Colin Brown came in. He did have damage on the right side. Ray, you've got an observation?
The respect that we talked about in the beginning of the race, certainly not being shown today with having only two green flag laps out of 8. But you know, what I'm worried about is the debris that's already gotten down from these wrecks this early in the race with a limited number of sets of tires for these nationwide cars. I'm not so sure we're not going to see too many flat tires here as we get going.
And not only that, we've seen a lot of guys having to make evasive moves and slide the tires, so they're just ruining that set of tires, having to get them off. So, yeah, these early cautions are taking its toll.
Looks like the old veteran Mike Bliss didn't cut Trevor Bayne too much of a break there. I heard DJ talking about not bump drafting through the corners. He got a hold of him and just would not let go of him. And I know Mike's not a dirty driver, but Trevor went for a ride.
Well, you can see Danica in 18th position. She'll be on the high side. Again, it'll be Harvick now, the race leader. Tony Stewart just a couple of rows behind Danica as he's making his way back through the field after starting 32nd. So it's Harvick and Kyle Busch, Carl Edwards, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Joey Logano, Casey Kane. That is your top six as we are getting ready to go back to green flag racing here at Daytona International Speedway. And Harvick has taken the low line. Green flag's out, and we're racing again at Daytona. Oh, gonna try three wide. Look out, that may not work. In the middle there, that is Ricky Stenhouse Jr., his first appearance here at Daytona. I'm not sure he wants to be there.
I can guarantee he doesn't want to be, but sometimes you get yourself put in that position. He would like to get out of there as soon as possible.
But he made it through, and whoa, look out. That looked like one of Michael Annette in the 15.
I heard Danica saying, was the race going to be more structured? I don't think so. Pretty chaotic right here.
22, Brad Keselowski. So far, that transmission linkage seems to be doing okay. He pulls in front of Danica and should wish Brad a happy birthday. He turned 26 just yesterday.
And you can see Danica trying to get back to the bottom of the racetrack there. That's where she's a little more comfortable, what she's done. But actually got forced back and actually put in the middle right there for a minute.
Trying to get back down low. She looks like she's having a hard time keeping the car down.
She's got Tony Stewart now right on her back bumper. She can latch onto that four car. She'll go back to the front.
Yeah, and I'd have to say maybe her car and a lot of these other guys' cars are looser than what they anticipated from what we saw the last few days practice-wise. Again, there's not as much rubber down right now, so it's going to take a little adjusting.
And we've not seen any big, big packs in practice, and they can't avoid that now. It is one big pack.
So far, Tony is staying in pretty much the same location in relationship to Danica. And here comes three wide. That's Michael Annette in the middle, down low. Stephen Wallace in the 66, and Leffler in the 10.
Now, the one thing about it with these cars, they're a little more easy to drive, and you can actually go forward in the middle with the aero package that they have versus what the cup cars and the way that they drive. So if you can get some help, you can make that work. By yourself, though, you're not going anywhere.
Down the backstretch, as all this action unfolds, Trevor Bayne has been released from the medical care center. Doc is with him.
Well, Trevor, very hard hit. What happened?
I don't know, man. It's pretty unbelievable to see something like that happen that early in the race, you know. We were just riding, you know, like lap five or something. I got a big shove through the middle of turn three and four here. I got under the seven, came down the front stretch, was still getting a huge push. I start kind of waving off, checking up, get shoved into the 15, still getting the push, and then I get in the center of the corner and the push never stopped. You know, I don't know what happened or what the 40 car, you know, what in the world was going on there to be that early in the race. Guess he's trying to push us to the lead in lap one, but you know, it's disheartening for this team to see something like this happen. You know, sometimes we pray before the race to keep us safe, and that happened. But, you know, our prayer to win, sometimes that doesn't get answered, but it's with all the right intentions. You know, so we just we got to stay strong here and fight back. Got a long season ahead of us here. It's unfortunate to see something like this happen this early in the season, this early in the first race. We'll see what we can do with it.
Very tough day for a talented young driver. Marty?
Thanks, Doc. It is a tough break for the 18-year-old, but he's got many more great days ahead of him. Look at the top five here, folks, as they come through. They're trying to pull away from the group. It is Harvick, Earnhardt, Edwards, Logano, and in fifth, John West Townley in that Richard Childress car.
Well, he's doing a great job up there. He started up front. He stayed up there. That Childress car has got good power.
Yeah, they've always had good stuff here between their cars and the power that they make. And John West is doing a nice job right now.
Coming down the backstretch, you can see that Danica Patrick has dropped back to 34th. And they said, if the comfort level's not there, go ahead and do that. Get to that first pit stop and make changes on the car. We noticed that she was looking like she was hunting up the track. Let's talk a little bit more about John West Townley. He has got Kyle Busch closing in on him for fifth.
So, guys, this is a good team, as mentioned, behind John West Townley. This is the group that ran the 29 car last. last year with veterans Clint Bowyer and Jeff Burton at the wheel for most of the races. Quite a different challenge for crew chief Dan Dieringhoff in this group, working with a young, inexperienced driver. But Dieringhoff told me in the test sessions that they did, he was pleasantly surprised with the ability of John West Townley. He had 10 DNFs last year, and that was goal number one, finish races. Be there at the end. So far, he's doing a nice job here in the early going.
Well, he did a nice job last week also in the ARCA race. He came home third in that event. But he may get an education from Kyle Busch here pretty soon on the aerodynamics of Daytona.
Yeah, and it's a learning experience for him, too, to be in this. He'd never had a car this good in this series, so that's going to help his learning curve even more. So we may see things that we may say, well, that might surprise us a little bit because of what we've seen from him in the last couple of years, but you get in good equipment, you can show a lot more.
These six cars have checked out on the rest of the pack by 1.2 seconds.
Well, they're running single file, and you see this second group now, two by two.
That's Justin Allgaier, last year's Rookie of the Year in the 12 car, leading this second group.
I can promise you there are a lot of guys hollering on their radio of adjustments they're going to want because they just have not been in a pack in situation like this all week long. So now their cars are doing things differently than what they anticipated.
Yeah, riding with Justin Allgaier in the 12 car. He's got his teammate Brad Keselowski in that 22 now, moving his way to the front.
In that second group with Allgaier, it's Brad Keselowski, Casey Kane, Brian Vickers, and Ricky Stenhouse Jr., Greg Biffle. And we mentioned the fact that Danica was going to go where the comfort level was. Well, she has dropped back. And
Stay with him. Try to help him.
She's 33rd right now. That's Tony Raines right in front of her.
What she's got to be careful of right here is not to lose the draft of this big pack in front of her. That's what you hear the crew chief there saying. Just stick with that car in front of you and try to catch that group.
Kyle Busch has gotten around the 21 of John West Townley. So bump Townley down to six, move Kyle up to fifth. That's the only change amongst the top 10 in the last few laps. I'm all right. Welcome back to the NASCAR Nationwide Series opener here at Daytona. Make sure to go to NASCAR.com for all your latest NASCAR information. You're looking down at the top six, led by Kevin Harvick. Can tell you Michael McDowell during the break had to come back in. He lost a tire, did not bring out the caution, but he now finds himself four laps down. No start and park so far. Four cars either off or out. Bliss Bane Teague and Chrissy Wallace. How about the guys who have dominated here? The last eight February winners. Four by Tony Stewart. Dale Earnhardt has three. Kevin Harvick has one. And here comes Tony. Remember, he started 32nd. He's now 11th. Junior second. Harvick first. And about the rest of the others in this pack, let's check in with Dave Burns.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. this week has been talking about how good this race car feels to him, how it's been turning, how it's been responding. And I asked Pops Jury about it this morning. He said, well, you know what? Junior's never been in this car. This car has been raced by Brad Keselowski for 2 years, and we've been working on it. It's the best car in our fleet, and we think it's the best one we've ever built. The second best one is being run today by Danica Patrick, but this is a car that Junior's never been in, and he feels like can get him to victory lane. Jamie?
And behind him is Carl Edwards. Before that last caution flag, Carl and Kevin Harvick had a close encounter. Carl came on the radio and said, man, he almost wrecked us across my hood. Guys, let's remember that for later in the race. Carl's car right now, okay, as he runs around third. Marty?
117 combined Nationwide Series victories among the top five drivers right there in your picture. There is the second pack, and look for the number four of Tony Stewart. He is now leading that pack. Stewart has moved up to seventh. He is without a doubt the biggest mover, along with Paul Menard. They have each picked up 25 spots. Menard is a little bit further back still, but he also is coming. He has moved up to 17th position. Look for the 98, and you'll find him.
See the tape on the nose there where he got in that little contact with Chrissy Wallace on the first lap.
It's Michael Annette right in front of him. And Annette's been looking good all week here at Daytona. And just to give you an update there, you can see Danica is now 13 seconds behind. She started 15th, running in 33rd. As she's still a long way from going a lap down, but she has lost contact with that pack. Let's get more from Dave Burns.
Marty, looking at the 98 car of Paul Menard, he was not one of the cars whose teams negotiated for points in the offseason so that he had something to fall back on in case it rained out qualifying. So when rain did come on Friday and qualifying was blocked out, Paul Menard was in a position to go home. Fortunately, team management got involved, did a little negotiating with some of the guys who maybe weren't going to run the whole race here today, and got Paul into this field. Remember, their plan is to run the entire season this year and run Paul for the championship. So they had a lot at stake and a lot of reason to negotiate with some of the other teams.
I love the term negotiating. On board with Justin Allgaier right there with the 43 of Scott Lagacy Jr. And he was one of the best-looking Fords early in the first practice. Lagacy, of course, lost his ride midway through last year right after our August race in Iowa. And the 43. And as you can see, we're going to open up here to give you perspective on the track. There go the race leaders underneath. Then that second pack with Tony Stewart leading the way there in seventh. And there is the third group, and Danica Patrick all the way back there trying to get back into it. She's 34th now, Vince.
Well, as DJ and Andy suggested, the handling becomes more difficult the deeper you get into the fuel run, and Danica's handling on this car is going away some. Says she's got a significant push in the dog leg, and the car's loose coming out of turn four, and she's having trouble keeping it from slipping up the track. So obviously they want to keep it down on the yellow line, being more difficult to do. Her spotter, Chip Ross, encouraging her, stay in the draft with the cars in front of you, but she's got a car that's not to her comfort level right now.
And we saw that. We saw that, guys, a couple of those laps where she was starting to drift up the mountain, going up the hill. All right, let's go back to the lead because Danica tries to maintain station and get to that first all-important pit stop, Tony Stewart is pulling the second group into contact with the first group.
Yeah, it won't be long. He'll be up there in that lead pack.
Right now, he is 2.2 seconds back from Kevin Harvick. While Tony tries to reel in the field, Kevin Harvick's trying to figure out what's going to happen on this first round of pit stops. What's the plan in their pit, Doc?
Well, Marty, a year ago, Kevin Harvick driving his own car. They got it done on the racetrack, but at times the Achilles heel for this team was what happened on pit road. You see, Kevin Harvick would borrow or lease a crew from a Cup team to do his car on Saturday. That all changed over the winter. Kevin bit the bullet and hired an entire pit crew, and they practiced 3 days a week at the shop with the trainer. How much will that make a difference? Well, we're going to find out the moment of truth about 10 laps away.
Well, Harvick in control right now as he leads Dale Earnhardt Jr., Carl Edwards, Joey Logano, Kyle Busch here at Daytona with a lot of laps left. Back here at Daytona International Speedway, where Kyle Busch has jumped up to second position while we were in the commercial break, and Tony Stewart has brought the freight train along with him. Look at this group that is tightened up here at Daytona at the top four. Take a look from high above, get you the perspective. Our aerial coverage brought to you by DirecTV. DirecTV, it'll change your life. Just call 1-800-DIRECTV. So let's reset it for you. It's Harvick, Kyle Busch, Joey Logano third, Junior is fourth, Dale Jr., Carl Edwards fifth, Tony Stewart is now sixth, and in seventh is Greg Biffle. And it is going to get a lot more interesting. There's Carl Edwards. He sort of got shuffled back right as we went to break, and now he has fallen into the clutches of Tony Stewart. That's a lap traffic down below him, the 81 of Michael McDowell, who is seven laps off the pace.
We've gotten to that point in the run where the tires have enough wear on them that they're having to lift off the throttle just a little bit in the corners, and you can see some of the better handling cars now moving their way to the front. You see the 18 cars made his way to second.
The 38 right behind this group, there he is, Casey Kane. He's also in this mix as well. And we'll still tell you, give you an update, there's still only the four cars that have crashed out of this event that have pulled behind the wall into the garage area. So not starting park's not been a problem today.
No. Tony's been able to make this move to catch this front pack with Greg Biffle there in the 27 car helping push him. Greg's been able to stay right with him most of the time. That's a lap car right there. You see Tony passing Mike Wallace.
Biffle gets under the 0-1 as well.
Now Danica is 34th right now. Let's listen in on the radio.
I'm trying. He got such a big loss of speed out of four that I could pass him, and then, you know, just one or the other.
Yeah, drafted when that happens. Neither one of you got enough help to where you can do anything, so when that happens, you just got to roll up at the throttle, touch his bumper, and push him. Because you're trying to catch that pack in front of you. Y'all trying to work as a team together to get back up there.
Okay.
And if the first time she does that, I guarantee you she's never done that in an Indy car.
Well, she's finding a lot of things here today.
No, they don't. Okay, we're getting closer to pit stops here as we are working lap number 37 of 120. And your race leader is Kevin Harvick, but this one is far from over. 34 of the 39 laps we've completed here in the Drive for COPD 300 at Daytona. Right behind him, though, is the defending series champion, Kyle Busch, followed by Joey Logano, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Tony Stewart has moved up into fifth, and he's got the high line right here.
Yeah, Tony's been on the bottom of the racetrack most of the time, but sometimes you stay down there that long, you'll wear that right front tire out a little bit, so Tony may be moving up to free his car up just a little. See as he's going by Joey Logano here, gets a nice pull.
Yeah, you see Logano losing a couple of spots. That's usually a product of having to get out of the throttle coming off the corner previous, and you lose so much momentum down the next straightaway. So a lot of cars, a lot of drivers out there struggling with the handling.
And you want to know why we talked about Tony Stewart, Kevin Harvick, and Dale Earnhardt Jr. with the last eight wins? Look where they are. Kyle Busch is second. They've got the other three spots.
Yeah, and I'm pretty sure Kyle Busch has probably been saying all week, you know, they talk about this stuff, and my name's never mentioned about this. And even though he's someone we should, he's led laps here before, and he certainly has been right in the mix. He was on Tony's bumper last year, tried to give him a little push to get his Daytona trophy. But, you know, that's four of the best right there running in that top four. Of course, Biffle has a cup win here.
And we're showing those viewers who may have just tuned in where Danica Patrick is. A lot of people are watching for the first time that may not have watched before. She's on the verge, though, of potentially going a lap down. She really needs a caution to stay on the lead lap, or she probably will lose it come pit stops.
Yeah, looks like Stewart's going to get another spot from Dale Earnhardt Jr. right here. Got a nice run in the corner on the high side. I think he's going to be able to clear Jr.
And Biffle's coming right along with him in the 27.
Yeah, Tony looks like he just hasn't had to come out of the throttle, and Biffle's sticking right there with him. They're just making pass every lap.
Did I see a gesture by Harvick there? Is he trying to signal something to Kyle Busch?
They're coming up on pit stops. It won't be long. He'll be making his, so they're going to be using some hand signals to get themselves in position.
Boy, look at this. From 32nd at the start of the race, Tony has got a run on Kyle. He's going to look to the inside going into three.
Yeah, you see?
Yeah, there. I thought I saw him waving his hand.
He's going to come in this time. And to make sure he doesn't get run over. This was a very critical point of the race, and trying to get on pit road is so hard without getting run over.
Yeah, that might be what Tony, the reason he went to the bottom. Yeah, he's going to pit with Harvick.
So the teammates, car owner Kevin Harvick and his driver in the number four, Tony Stewart, will come down together. So will Greg Biffle, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Carl Edwards. Doc, it's all yours.
Let's see if Kevin Harvick's offseason investment in a pit crew does pay off. He said four tires, guys, no adjustments. The car is that good. Dave.
The four car of Tony Stewart says it feels like it's sagging on the right rear, needs to be popped up a little bit. They talked about a track bar adjustment, but then Smoke waved off on that and said, I want to go for Wedge. Four tires for him. Dale Earnhardt Jr. in as well with a loose race car. They'll fix that. Jamie?
Carl Edwards says he's just a tick tight. He actually has to lift coming off two. Wedge adjustment, air pressure adjustment. Four tires. He wants a room temperature bottle of water, and he's down and away. Oh, he stalls it. Uncharacteristic of Carl Edwards. He is down and away, guys.
Well, it looks like you're having some trouble getting the cobwebs kind of blown out here. All the pit crews, a few mistakes, and now you see even a mistake by Carl Edwards.
Yeah, we saw the tire roll off from Tony's crew. They were able to get it back before he pulled out, so no penalty. Now, John West Townley, watch the 21 back of your screen on the left side. And he ran out of a little bit of racing room there and boop, see that?
Well, he didn't need to be up beside that six car. He needs to follow him in there.
Jamie, let's check in with you on this.
Oh, we have a couple of teammates, Braun Racing teammates, pitting now. The 38 is, of course, Casey Kane. He says his car is just a tick tight as well. Four tires, fuel, and they're going to make an air pressure adjustment. The 32 of Brian Vickers, his teammate, we'll see him in this car eight times. No adjustment. adjustment. Says the car is handling great. They're just down on speed. Four tires for that bright yellow car of Brian Vickers.
And we can tell you John Westhelling's going to get a pass through for running over the cone. He was 11th when he came into the pit. So that's going to hurt him there. And you can see we still have Kyle Busch and Joey Logano, Brian Vickers, Casey Kane, Michael Annette, Scott Riggs. These guys have yet to pit. Let's check in once again with Doc.
And here's Joey Logano on pit road. They are going to make a chassis adjustment. Joey said this car is in a four-wheel drift in the corner, a four-wheel slide. He said, free it up a little bit so I can get the car to turn and be consistent. He wanted to wait a lap or two. Uneventful stop for Logano.
So as Joey comes back out right behind him, there you see John Westhelling as he is doing his pass-through penalty. And we're waiting to see when Kyle Busch will drop below the line to bring it in for his pit stop.
Now that penalty was for hitting that cone. You can't hit that cone that signifies where the pit road speed starts. Here comes Kyle on the pit road now.
So as the 18 comes in, we get word that the 62 of Brendan Gaughan is going to get a penalty for a pit road equipment violation. Let's check in with Dave Burns.
18 of Kyle Busch is in now. What he wanted from the car, it actually got pretty balanced over that run. The nose was floating at first, but then the tire wear caught up with it, and it was fairly balanced. But that chassis adjustment in the back window, that's to help the car be a little bit freer at the start of the run. Just a little bit looser so it comes around better in these turns. Brendan Gaughan goes by for his pass-through penalty, and off of pit road goes Kyle Busch.
Pretty darn good pit time there, 15.2.
Yeah, no problems right there. Everything looked pretty clean. He's going to have to blend in with the cars now that did pit. You see Danica Patrick now making her first
right
green flag pit stop.
Right there, 4,000.
She looks like she's running awful all fast down, pit 4, road speed. I don't know. Down. We'll see.
And you're 15. And you're 10. Get away right around this black car right here. 5, 4, 3, right here. Nice easy. Come on. Looking good. You're going to stop right there, baby. Good. Straight wheel straight, right?
Four tires and two rounds down on the track bar for Danica Patrick. They will give her four tires at each and every stop because Tony Urey Jr. thinks it's most important that she has the consistent car so they won't gamble on their pit stops.
Go, go, go. Easy, easy, easy on that motor. Easy. You're good. Just go get all you get. Left after the deal. Left on the yellow. Left on the yellow. Left on the yellow around turn one.
She's used to hammering the throttle because they got rev limiters over an IndyCar.
Yeah, you got to be careful when you drop that jack and you rev that thing up. You can, you know, a couple things. You can break some of the drivetrain parts, and you can also over-rev the motor. Even though they do have rev limiters also, you still have to be careful with it.
Yeah, but these things are so hard. They have such a high gear in them, and they're hard to get going out of that spot. As we see a battle here now, this is all the guys right up front after these pit stops.
Joey Logano, Greg Biffle, followed by Carl Edwards. You've also, well, pick your favorite driver because they're there. There's Smoke, the 88 of Dale Jr., the 33 of Harvick, and the 18 of Kyle Busch. Also want to pass along another penalty. Jeff Green in the 05, a pass-through penalty, non-compliant fueling. So that's going to hurt their day here at Daytona. On board with Tony. He's about to get a little nudge, maybe.
Yeah, they're feeling a little more racy now with these new tires on.
Yeah, everybody feels like Superman for a few laps there. You get that, especially after you've run almost 50 laps with those tires before. Of course, a lot of these guys are like Superman.
That's what I say. How about Biff? He's great. Gained 24 spots now.
And as you look at this group, we got to point out, don't forget, Tony Raines, Joe Nemechek, Eric McClure, Sauter. They have not pitted yet, and there is Tony. They still got to come in. Remember, they came in earlier. Raines pitted on lap number 10, so he can go a little bit further.
Yeah, just hoping that they may get a break with a caution or something that would keep them in good shape.
Yeah, because if they do pit under the green, they're going to go back a lap down almost for sure. That's Morgan Shepherd right in front of the 27. And Nemechek wants to lead a lap, 5 bonus points and a little camera time.
Might as well take advantage of it. Going to stay out here. Let's do something with it.
Well, as he comes into the turn 3 area, if he holds on, he will lead the lap here. And that would give us our fourth different leader. The man who's led the most has been Kevin Harvick. He's had 37 of them. But we've got a lot more racing still to come here at Daytona.
Blue right rear, just find out.
We have come back from a commercial break because Mike Wallace in the 01 has spun it here at Daytona and has brought out our third caution.
Yeah, one thing that's done. Now, we had a few cars that had not pitted yet, so we're kind of in the middle of a cycle. Danica Patrick found herself a lap down, but she should get the lucky dog free pass right here because she's the first car lap down.
Well, and the three guys this really benefits also is Nemechek, Reigns, and Sauter. Well, he just lost it.
Yeah, it didn't look like any contact or anything. Just kind of went around.
Could a tire have possibly gone down?
Wow, went around pretty quick.
Yeah, really turned around going into the corner.
Well, he did manage to keep it off the wall, but started to slide back up the hill. Well, and you mentioned it. Danica Patrick gets the Aaron's lucky dog. So the race gods are smiling on her early as she'll get back on the lead lap here at Daytona as we are working lap number 52 of 120.
Yeah, that's a big break for her, but they really need to go to work now and try to get her further up in this line, and she needs to probably be a little more aggressive.
At the end of the run, I felt like the balance came back to me. It was like it started off okay, and then it went to oversteer for a while, and then it went and balanced out at the end. So I could keep my foot in the throttle more than everyone else, it looked like, because, I mean, I thought I kept a pretty decent gap once I got by.
Hey, you did good. You just got to really work on trying to get in there. I know the car ain't right, you can't do it, but you just got to really try to hustle that thing to where you can stay, keep that gap. You got a car length between that car. When you go into the corner, you want to keep it. That's what your main goal is, and that way both cars run faster.
Yeah, it's almost like I get up behind him and I get like the aero push and then it catches the oversteer or something. Because it's really just on the edge when I'm right behind people. If I just, drop back a car length or two and go a little bit lower than them, I mean, it just feels 10 times better.
Yeah, but she, like I said, you could hear Tony Jr. telling her she needs to be a little more aggressive to try to stay up with the cars in front of her and try to stay with faster cars. This car is going to drive like she's talking about no matter where she's running, who she's running with. But if she's running up a little farther up, she will, at least not lose the draft.
And this is the feeling she's got to get comfortable with, and she's not right now.
Yeah, she has to. And she's talking about when she gets down underneath those cars that it feels better there. But you have to stay in that slipstream to really utilize the draft. And that's what she's going to have to really work on.
Well, you can see Nemechek, Reigns, and Sauter, they're going to finally make their pit stops, as also Tony Stewart's going to come in. But you saw that it looked like the 18 stayed out of Kyle Busch.
Yeah, he did stay on the track, but now remember, he made his pit stop a lot later than some of the other cars.
There's smoke on the right side of your screen. A lot of damage on that 34 of Tony Reigns. He came in second place. Joe Nemechek, Johnny Sauter. Bet you never thought we'd have that in a triple box, but there's your three leaders
that
came in. So let's give them their due.
And see Carl Edwards coming off pit road just ahead of Tony Stewart.
Here comes Nemechek out as well. 38 of Casey Kane. There's Tony Reigns as he comes off. Kevin Harvick, how about the Nationwide Insurance race off pit road? And Dale Earnhardt Jr. picked up 4 spots. Carl Edwards picked up 6 from coming in.
How about Lagasse? Gains 10 spots there.
2 tires, as you can see, for Carl Edwards and none for Jr. and Tony Stewart. So Greg Biffle right now is shown as your race leader with Kyle Busch and Brad Keselowski with Paul Menard, who started dead last in the field, now 4. Back here at Daytona International Raceway, just past the bottom of the hour. It is the season opener for the NASCAR Nationwide Series. Glad that you're with us. We have had 5 different leaders with 5 lead changes. We've had 3 cautions for a total now of 11 laps, soon to be 12. Our leader is Greg Biffle right now, as he's a few cars back. They're getting the wave around right there. Here he is in the 27 car. And Danica Patrick has moved into the 27th position. She got the Aaron's lucky dog. And let's take it back during the commercial break. We told you about how pit stops could be crucial. Let's show you what happened.
Whoa. All right, you can go ahead and be easy on the motor. Switch.
Had that been green flag, that would have been a disaster.
Yeah, that would have cost her dearly there. And you got to be careful with the clutch and all the running gear right there. Like Dale said, these cars are geared real high, and it's difficult to get out of that pit stall.
Yeah, and that's a natural thing that's going to happen after they tell you not to over-rev the motor. You're going to stall it out. That's partly being a rookie, but you see other guys. Carl Edwards did it a while ago, too.
Two wave arounds to tell you about. 62 of Brennan gone and Stanton Barrett in the 31. We've got 31 total cars on the lead lap right now. Four cars are out of the race. Bliss, Bain, Teague, and Chrissy Wallace. Men's college basketball action continues on ESPN Saturday primetime and SEC Showdown. Number 12 Tennessee visits Rupp Arena to battle number 2 Kentucky. Saturday primetime presented by DirecTV. It's all part of Rivalry Week. Presented by Cisco on ESPN at 9 Eastern. Coverage begins with College Game Day driven by State Farm. At 8 Eastern. For more, just log on to ESPN.com. Let's check in with Dr. Jerry Punch.
Guys, remember we told you Kevin Harvick had made a major investment in the offseason with a new pit crew to see how they would do. Here's what he had to say about their first stop of the year.
If we lose this race because of a pit stop, I'm going to have a freaking heart attack.
Yeah, 10-4. Hopefully we got that bad one out of the way. We'll hopefully get her done from here on out.
Stop coaches, new shoes. Higher salaries, slower pit stops. Doesn't add up. I think you guys are getting tired. Everybody laughing on you at you on pit road.
Obviously, Kevin, not a happy camper right now. As we go back to green flag racing, it's Biffle, Kyle Busch, Menard, Keselowski, Riggs. That's your top five. Harvick is all the way back to 13th. That's why he's mad.
He was one of the cars there that took on four tires, a little different strategy than what some of these other ones did that had just been in not too many laps ago.
Keep an eye on that sixth-place car, Scott Riggs. Remember, this is an unsponsored race machine right now. We talk about opportunities to bring on a sponsor. You do real well in this race. It has a tendency to get people's attention.
Well, that's certainly why they're here, hoping that they can have some good things to happen where they can get some dollars to fund this team and continue to race.
Looking further back in the pack, Danica still trying to find that comfort level. She's still leaving about a car length and a half before she gets up underneath somebody.
Yeah, and that's just something that takes time and experience to get used to what you can do with this and what you have to do if you're going to continue to hold on to that draft.
Well, what's going to happen? You see a big pack right now. That's going to separate. You're going to have probably two or three packs in about 10 or 12 laps. She needs to make sure she's at the head of these things so she can stay with the faster cars. She needs to try to be more aggressive in this situation.
Coming down the backstretch now, still Biffle holding station. Brad Keselowski and Kyle Busch duking it out for second and third. Riggs doing a real nice job in that 09. He's tucked down on that low line. Here comes Junior to the middle of the racetrack. If somebody goes with him, here comes Smoke. That'll give him some help. It's Menard that may be left out on the high side.
Yeah, when you see drivers like this go to that middle, most time you say you don't want to be there, but they'll generally get some help, and it makes it look like that really works well.
Paul Menard saying, fellas, what'd you do to me? What did I do? He had worked his way all the way back up to fourth, but now he's getting the NASCAR Daytona shuffle all the way back as, Scott Riggs now up to fourth.
And you see Kyle Busch jump to that outside to get that push from Dale Jr. and Tony.
See, Riggs. Scott Riggs, yeah, he's made up 35 spots since the start of the race.
Just real impressed with the leader of this race, Greg Biffle, and this race team. They've been fast the entire time down here.
Remember, that's Baker Curb Racing, as he'll be running a limited schedule with them. And right now, out in front, back, there's checking in. There's Brendan Gaughan right behind Danica Patrick. Eric McClure on the high side. And you talked about losing contact. There's a lot more gap there from the last time we checked.
Yeah, she's doing what she needs to do there. She cars in front of her had to get out of the throttle. She took advantage of it. She was three wide for just a moment. That's what she needs to do right now.
Look at Kevin Harvick in the 33 trying to slice up the middle. Let's get an update on Kyle Busch as we watch all this action from Dave Burns.
Marty, sometimes the only way you can win at Daytona is to get partners to work with. But what if you're Kyle Busch and what if you've been feeling a little lonely out there? Listen to his radio.
Why is it that it seems that I have nobody that wants to work with me? Because they're already scared to death you're going to beat them. They don't want to help you.
Well, Jason Ratcliffe, the crew chief, told me this morning that getting this car to handle is the most important thing. You heard Kyle talk about that in our countdown show today. If they've got a great handling race car, he's already proven he can keep it at the front of the pack. If he can get someone to help him a little bit.
Well, it looks like another car has gotten shuffled to the middle as Carl Edwards got underneath the... Looked like Scott Riggs and sort of pushed him back a few spots.
Yeah, I think Scott Riggs is thinking the same thing Kyle Busch is. Why won't somebody work with me here? I got a good car. I'm up here. And they just hung him right in the middle.
Yeah, I can tell Kyle Busch, when he set all the records that he set last year, people get a little bit envious of things like that. So they're probably not going to be too willing to help him add something else to his resume.
How about Brad Keselowski in this 22 car? He's come all the way from the back now, and he's got this thing really going toward the front.
Transmission linkage. Thought they were going to have a problem right at the start of the race. It has not reared its ugly head. He is in second spot, side by side with Kyle Busch. Right behind him, Carl Edwards in the 60 and the 88 of Dale Earnhardt Jr. And there is Tony Stewart right behind the 88.
Now, looking at this 22 car, Brad Keselowski up there, I think we all questioned a little bit, how strong would they be adding a second team over there at Roger Penske's in the Nationwide Series? Did they have the people and the resources to get it all done to come out here strong? I think he's answering our question. Dave?
And DJ, they pulled from a number of different teams, including CGM Racing, JTG Racing, Baker Curb, Hendrick Motorsports, KHI, and put together a really solid group for this race. But they said one of the most important things was Brad's presence at the shop. He knows these race cars, he spent time with us, and he's the one who's got us most pumped up about coming to Daytona.
He's pumping that throttle pedal right now as he and Kyle Busch try and track down our race leader, but those three are trying to pull away. Looking in again on Danica, and not close enough to do any bump drafting yet, and that's going to have to be the next stop on her learning curve, is to get up tight enough that she can push somebody.
It looks like they've got her car handling a little bit better, though. She's a little more aggressive this run.
Yeah, she's doing what she needs to do right now. She's still right there in that big group of cars. Speaking of a big group, look at this group.
You got
three wide
Smoke
for a minute.
Yeah, Smoke was pushing the 88. Here comes Carl. And on the high side, looks like we may have another lead change as if it can hold on at the stripe. As Brad Keselowski looks like he is going to lead this lap, and that will give us our sixth different leader.
Contact there between Michael Annette and Casey Kane in that 38 car.
And they're still three wide. Man, there is a lot of skating going on. Michael Annette's the only hockey player in that whole group in the 15.
Yeah, Casey told us in the pre-race show that his car wasn't to his liking, and I'm not sure they've gotten it there yet.
Well, there's teammates right there, the 38 and the 10, and oh, got a tire rub, it looks like, right in front of him.
Yeah, that's Michael Annette, and I think maybe that left rear might be rubbing a little bit after that contact.
Also in this mix, the 32 of Brian Vickers, as you can see him there on the high side of the track. Let's get an update on his situation from Jamie.
He actually has a very damaged race car on those last round of pit stops. It was Bobby Gerhardt who checked up in front of Brian Vickers and smashed Vickers' nose. The good news is his temperatures are good right now, and even better news, he can still use the bumper, and he's just going nothing but forward, Marty.
Did you see Stewart go sideways? Whoa, manages to wheel and steer it back on course. But I think my heart was fluttering. I don't know about his.
Just another day at work for him.
Yeah, he probably said, what are you guys talking about?
Check it out.
There
another
we go.
Three wide.
This is right behind Tony. 27 of Biffle starting to get pushed back a little bit. He's got no help. He's hung out on the low side.
Tell you what we're seeing, these guys have been able to make some adjustments on these race cars, and they're getting a lot more racy now, which makes it a lot more fun for everybody.
Well, we have passed the halfway mark.
And, whoa, they're still sliding, though.
Still got a lot of racing to go, but you're right. They have picked up the tempo as far as the aggressiveness is a concern. Tony Stewart looking to go underneath the 22. As this battle up front, we keep swapping the lead. This could be our seventh lead change if it holds at the stripe. Coming down that backstretch, heading for turn number three.
Check out how far Harvick has come now. Restarted 13th, going for second from Brad Keselowski right now.
And he's underneath him, and you're right, the 33. Kevin Harvick doing the job out on the track. You heard the displeasure of the last pit stop.
Tell you somewhere else that Kevin Harvick's been getting it done, that's at the shop. The top two cars came out of KHI.
Yeah, and you don't like those bad pit stops, but sometimes there's nothing like a little bad effort there or fired up. Yeah, get that driver going.
So the guys that are running 1-2 have won the last five nationwide races here at Daytona in February. Tony Stewart has won four of them, and in 07, it was Kevin Harvick. One guy who would love to win for his first time here at Daytona is in that 60 car, Carl Edwards. He finished second last year to Stewart by 68/1,000th of a second. Kyle Busch down right behind him. Right now, it looks like the 22 needs some help from Dale Jr. They both have slid back a little bit.
Yeah, and I talked about these cars driving better, but I tell you what, these guys are wheeling these race cars. They are sideways. They've just got them better now to where they can hang on to them.
61 of Josh Wise is doing the smart thing. He's getting up way high and saying, fellas, go on by. And that's exactly what they're doing. There's their top five. We have passed halfway, but the fun is still more to come. I'm gonna go it alone. Multiple car crash, including Danica Patrick, among many others, here on the front straightaway. Brian Scott, the 21 of John West Townley. Colin Brown, the 31, is also in this mix of Stanton Barrett. That's what's left of the right front corner of Danica's car.
Yeah, this all developed in front of her, this crash did. She did a good job of avoiding most of it, but then just couldn't avoid all the cars in it.
Also in it is the 61 of Josh Wise, the 48 of Johnny Sauter. This is going
to
be a long
one. Wheels to the left. Go to it.
That's what's left of Josh Wise's car. And there is Ricky Stenhouse Jr. And his debut here at Daytona is pretty well torn up, and he's on fire.
Back to the 6. The 6 is on fire.
We've got parts and pieces all over this racetrack. And there is the fire still going. Stenhouse is out of the car, but this baby is burning. Okay, lower portion of your screen.
You can see just a little bit of misjudgment there.
Yeah, that was
61
a lap car.
Got turned.
And Josh Wise was a lap car, and he's...
And she had nowhere to go.
Yeah, she just, I mean, gets by that car right there, but there's just nothing. There's, I know it looks like room, but you're traveling at a high rate of speed, and she almost made it.
Take a look from another angle. A little lower this time.
See, all of this develop right there, and as these cars start sliding, more cars get involved, you just hope that a hole opens up for you.
10 of Leffler, boy, they had high hopes for this season. It's not going to start off the way they had wanted.
They had two of Roush's cars involved in that. Stenhouse and Colin Brown both involved.
There you go.
Okay, let's go on board and listen.
Doing a nice job. Still clear by three from behind. Spin in front of you. Back it down. He's up here against the wall. Up here against the wall. He's against the wall, against the wall, against the wall.
I thought she did a good job, but just nowhere to go. I mean,
yeah, it's just so much all that you can do. It's just hope. And you know, there's very little visibility that you have there. Again, even though you're slowing down, see right here, just didn't have quite enough room. She could see the cars on the left and knew she couldn't go there, so she just had to try to hold it and hope that that hole cleared out.
Well, Roush Fenway loses two cars in this deal, both Ricky Stenhouse Jr. and the 16 of Colin Brown. All right, let's listen live right now.
Man, that was a mess. I think something's just... I couldn't turn it up the hill. I have to turn so far to the left to keep going straight. Something's really, really broken.
Yeah, we can guarantee you that. It is definitely got some damage to it.
Yeah, you know, Andy and I were just talking and watching her how much better she was doing this time of keeping up with the draft and the pack and a little bit more aggressive. I'm sure part of that was her getting more used to it and then working on the car, but she really was doing a good job
here. She actually picked up six spots from 27th to 21st, and that was by passing on the racetrack. So it wasn't stuff that she had inherited, but you can see the damage now as the big one has happened here in our season opener at Daytona, and we've still got a big mess to clean up. Stay with us, though. Our fourth caution has taken out a lot of race cars.
We are just past halfway today at Daytona International Speedway, and a multi-car accident off Turn 4 has claimed, among others, Danica Patrick's machine, that car being pushed back toward the garage. While the field is brought down pit road, the pit road is closed, but the leader's being brought down pit road to avoid running through all the debris that this multi-car accident off Turn number 4 has scattered all across the racetrack. Let's get caught up on what's happened so far with the 5-hour energy rapid recap. Danica Patrick's NASCAR debut from the 15th starting position, and had some ups and downs on the day. First of all, barely missed a wreck at lap 7.
Oh, yeah, but look at this. He did a great job getting through the traffic. Checks up a little bit there, pulls that baby down to bottom side, misses everybody. Good run early for her.
We talked before the start of the race about pit stops and what they would be like. Danica down pit road on her second stop, getting some instructions from the crew.
All right, you go ahead, be easy on the motor.
Looks like she stalled out there, and that is a difficult situation she's in. She's been worried about this all week long, and it did happen to her. She stalled the car out, couldn't get it rolling, and cost herself a few spots on pit road.
And then the big wreck, and trouble found Patrick off turn number 4. The wreck starting up in front of her, and just no place to go.
No, and she was doing a good job, had the car better coming up through the field. Unfortunately, when you go to the back, you have a tendency to maybe get caught up in things like this. As you can see there, she just clips the car, turns across, no fault of her own, out into the outside wall.
10 cars involved in that wreck that began, it looked like, when the 61 of Josh Wise was clipped by the 16 of Colin Brown, and all those cars swept into the mess. As far as the lead is concerned, up front it is Tony Stewart, who is still running behind the pace car, waiting on pit stops while pit road is still closed. Radio from the 7 car just after the wreck.
The last time they crashed in front of me, I just held it straight and they spun below me. This time I kept it straight, hoping they'd spin out of the way, and they did.
The tough thing about this, she didn't do anything wrong whatsoever. The problem is you have no vision. I mean, it's like a Days of Thunder movie. It's all smoke. You're just going through it. You're hoping you clear, and all of a sudden, bam, there's a car parked in front of you. I mean, she learned a lot today, no doubt about that. Cars tore up pretty bad. She'll come back and learn from this experience. But I really can't put a fault on her at all right now, Ray.
No, I can't either, Rusty. Now, as you said, you're going 190 miles an hour. You're trying to slow down, get run over from the back. Car's moving. Can't see where you're going. Did what she could.
Well, we knew this was a possibility in this race today for her. So the worst scenario has played itself out. She got some good laps in. She learned a little bit today. Now she'll move forward, and we look forward to seeing her racing again when it's not a restricted plate race to see what she can really do.
That'll be next Saturday at California with the second race of the season. Meanwhile, that is John West Townley, who's going to be held one lap. Remember, I talked about how NASCAR was bringing the field down pit road to allow the safety workers clear access to the front straightaway to clean up the mess. Well, John West didn't get that message, or there was some confusion there, but he ran through the front straightaway instead of going down the pit road, and so he's being penalized one lap by NASCAR. So, caution is out for a 10-car wreck off turn number 4, just past halfway in today's race, and Danica Patrick's NASCAR debut is done. Still under caution here at Daytona International Speedway. Pit road still closed. While Danica Patrick talks with Tony Urie Jr. about her Daytona experience and the experience that ended it in the big 10-car pileup off of turn number 4 just a minute ago.
Yeah, just found herself in the wrong place at the wrong time, even though she was doing a better job getting her car up to speed and trying to race with some of these guys, and just had nowhere to go.
Hey, you see Josh Wise come off of turn 4, gets tapped behind from Colin Brown. All heck breaks loose. Everybody's involved in it. Both the Rouse's cars are tore up, and Danica, no place to go. Got the right front fender took off to suspension. She learned a lot, though.
Wow, cars through the grass, cars on the track, cars on the pit road, everywhere. This is your very typical trouble in turn 4 at Daytona.
It is, and there ain't no way, as they say, to experience it without experiencing it. So, you know, she got a world of experience there today. It's a shame, as I said, she was doing a good job bringing that car back up through the field after adjustments having a pit stop.
Now, check out this. 5 of the 6 drivers making their first Daytona start have been involved in accidents. And what was it you said to me during the commercial?
I said, if I was the 6th guy, I'd be looking for a safe place.
All right. Dr. Punch is down by the care center where some of those involved in the wreck have come out.
Not a good day for 2 Roush Fenway drivers. A couple of impressive rookies, Ricky Stenhouse on the right, Colin Brown on the left. Guys, from your vantage point, what happened?
Well, I couldn't see anything. I just saw a bunch of smoke and tried to lock it down there and get to the bottom, but I don't know, one of the cars came across the outside and got us in the right front. But all in all, I mean, I learned a lot today, had a lot of fun. It was a blast out there. Just too bad for our City Financial Ford Fusion. We didn't want to start the season this way, but, you know, we'll have to go on to California and shake it off and get back up there.
Hey, Colin?
Well, for me, I mean, I guess I was kind of right in the middle of it. I don't know exactly what happened. I got, I guess, put in a bad spot. That 61 moved around, and next thing I know, I was getting pushed down from behind and the side and everywhere. So I just feel bad for my number 16 Conway Freight Ford Fusion guys. They did a really good job on that car. Struggled there early on, but my crew chief, Eddie Pardue, made a good adjustment, and I thought we were pretty fast and pretty good there towards the end of that run.
All right, a couple of Rookie of the Year candidates out here just past the halfway.
All right, Doc, thanks, and I think I'm seeing the signal here that pit road is going to be open this time. And so this is going to be a set of, well, get that safety truck out of the way. This is going to be a crucial set of pit stops here, Ray.
It really is. They're right on their window. Back in the old days, if we said, hey, you know, come in, put your tires on, and you're done. But right now, with a new green-white checker rule, could extend it.
45 to go, Doc.
And this final pit stop, well, it should be the final pit stop if we stay green. 33, Kevin Harvick coming back down. Remember the trouble they had early on, the problems with the jack. A jack is one pump and a bump. Thus far, it is flawless. Dave.
Tony Stewart's fast race car is really, really loose. They're going to put as much Sunoco fuel as they can get in there to go to the end, but they're going to make an air pressure adjustment. Already made a wedge adjustment to try to tighten it up. Jamie.
Carl Edwards wants to free it up a bit. Track bar adjustment up. Sunoco fuel. Four tires. They told him to save fuel. Be cognizant. 12, and he has a little bit of trouble going up. 14.5 for Carl Edwards.
All right, so Edwards got to the scoring line at pit exit first, although they had that hiccup trying to stall it. Everybody with four tires, and again, Kevin Harvick now going to be in the fourth position, and Tony Stewart, the big loser on that round of stops.
Hey, that's what you got to do, though. No two tires, none of that stuff. Just pour four in these things, pack them full of fuel, because it looks to me, Ray, they're going to be able to go all the way if they choose to do so. Tires are very, very important here. If a caution does come back out, they need to come back down, get some tires on that thing, because handling is going to become an issue late in this race.
And we got to remember, we saw earlier that the 88 and the 4 chose not to take tires, so they could have an extra set of tires.
A quick reminder before we get the restart that the NHRA season is getting underway out in Pomona, California. As always, it's the Craig and O'Reilly NHRA Winter Nationals qualifying 11 Eastern tonight here on ESPN2, and the finals 8 Eastern time on Sunday. After a rainout last night, the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series runs its season opener here at Daytona tonight. Little day-night doubleheader Daytona. That's on speed at 7 Eastern time. Tomorrow morning, the Daytona 500 preview edition of NASCAR Now at 9 a.m. Eastern on ESPN2. I got to get you out of bed early, Brad, for Sunday morning work.
No problem. We can do it.
And then the Monday roundtable wrap-up of the Daytona 500. That's 5 Eastern time. Next weekend, it's on to California with NASCAR Nationwide Series race number 2. That's Saturday at 5 Eastern with NASCAR Countdown on ESPN2. We got a lot going on in the next few days. We got a lot going on after this restart with 45 laps to go. So let's head to break with this latest round of pit stops and Mark Hollywood Armstrong take us for a trip.
Okay, guys, here we go. Just need a nice, smooth stop on a 5-hour Toyota. Kids, don't try this at home.
Want to know why Carl Edwards is the leader? Tony Stewart's a little bit further back. Let's take you to the pit stop. This is how important they really are. Watch the right front on the number 4. This is a problem.
Yeah, you can see right here, they're making the right side stop. They get it up, get the tire off. Everything's clean so far. Right there, they have a hard time getting that tire in that hole now. That fender is so tight. These speedway cars, you get so much gain from those cars having those tight fender wells, but it can really hurt you on these pit stops.
So Tony finds himself back in 7th, and look at the difference, 17.2, 3 seconds and change. And the tight wheel well comes back to haunt the number 4, but he's got enough car underneath him. Don't count him out by any stretch of the imagination. Let's reset it for you. It's Edwards, Kyle Busch, Logano, Harvick, Earnhardt Jr., Brad Keselowski, Tony Stewart, Greg Biffle. That's your top 8. Here we go back to green. Bush has got the high side working this time. Harvick right behind him. But here comes Edwards right back. Yeah, on these restarts, it's just a matter of who gets a good push, who's going to be able to get out front. Down the backstretch, Kyle Busch opening up a little bit of room. Got about a car length on the 33, but here comes the 60 of Edwards, and here comes Kyle down to the low side. While all this is going on, Vince is caught up with Danica Patrick.
Certainly didn't end the way Danica had hoped. What did you see or not see on that incident?
I think it was not see. You know, in the very first accident that happened in 1 and 2, cars came together, smoke, and I just kind of like let off the throttle and slowed down, and they slid down the track. And then this one, you know, there's smoke, and I can't see anything again. And, you know, I try and just slow down and roll it through the corner, and then, you know, and that time it, you know, we all hit. So that's the tough thing about this racing. I can see what they've all said all along with these big tracks is, you know, smoke comes up and you're running so close out there that, you know, there's nowhere to go. But and the disappointing part more than anything is just that, you know, I missed out on getting, you know, 40 or whatever laps left of experience that I could have got. And the car was finally, you know, where I liked it. And I felt confident as a driver to be able to run in a pack. So I was finally kind of getting the hang of it.
Albeit a shorter experience than what you wanted, what do you take from today?
Well, I can tell you that I'll be a lot more confident and prepared for next year. This is some really difficult racing. It really is. You know, the cars are definitely on the edge here. And as you can see, you know, someone gets a little bit out of shape and everybody's on top of each other. And then, you know, since the car don't slow down, it doesn't slow down very well, and you're already on the edge of grip, that everything happens. So, you know, I'm glad that I got that second stint in to be able to get more confidence out there. But it's never fun when, you know, crash up a perfectly good car that wasn't your fault.
Danica Patrick done for today, but back on track next week at Fontana. Marty.
Well, welcome to Restrictor Plate Racing. And boy, take a look at the action that we have going on up front. It is our 10th different leader, 12 total lead changes. The record is 12 leaders, set back in 1995. It's Edwards, Kyle Busch, Jr., Harvick, Stewart, Vickers. That's your top six. And we want to salute DirecTV for our aerial coverage. DirecTV, it'll change your life. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. A little bit further back there is Casey Kane in the 38. And it looks like Rusty's two guys have hooked up. That's Brendan Gaughan right in front of the 66 of Stephen Wallace. All of that is for 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th.
And you see Joey Logano in that mix, too. He was up there, tried to make it three wide and advance up into the top five, and they kind of left, hung him out to dry, and now he's back outside of the top 10.
Yeah, looks like Junior hung him in the middle there, or hung him to the bottom side. He lost that momentum. See him now getting racy up front.
Yeah, that's what they're doing to Kyle now.
Yeah, see you, Kyle. We're going to dump you here. Bye-bye.
That's exactly what they did to Logano.
He's going, oh, man.
Where are my friends?
That's what happens, like you said, when you win the championship.
Kind of lonely down there.
Here comes, for the lead, Dale Jr. He's got help from Harvick down low. Here comes Stewart. Looks like Carl's going to get the shuffle. All of a sudden, also, keep an eye on that 32 of Vickers. He's got that car dialed in after that last round of pit stops.
Yeah, and Vickers knows what to do with this draft, too. He's run well here in the past. Hadn't talked much about him today, but it's coming time to get down and decide who's going to win this thing, and he wants to be part of it.
Brad Keselowski in the mix right behind Vickers. And remember, driving a Dodge, and Dodge has not won a nationwide race since August of 2007. That's right. It's been that long. Jamie, what's the latest on the 32?
Well, remember, I reported he had that damage on the front of his nose. I believe that is actually helping him now. After the damage, he got shuffled back to 23rd. He says the car is great now. Haven't made any adjustments. They have two sets of sticker tires left.
Okay, if that's the case, Mike Tyson would have been much better if he had his nose punched in all the time. Take a look here at you got the Carl Edwards, the 18, and all of a sudden we've got a caution coming out.
We've got debris caution. Yeah, we've got a lot of cars that had some damage, probably taped up, and some of it's come loose.
Well, that's one piece out there. And that's on the back stretch. So we are going to have now our fifth caution. field will slow down and we'll regroup. Now, question is, do you pit?
Well, I mean, they can obviously probably make it on fuel if they don't have any extension as far as green-white checkers go. I'm at the back of the pack, or mid-pack, and I've got a set of tires. Wouldn't hurt to get them on right now.
We got 25 cars on the lead lead lap, it's easy for me to say. Jeff Green is the first car, one lap down. So he will get the lucky dog.
I'd like to have tires right now.
Yeah, I'd have to think that they may think there's going to be another caution, and if they do have a set of tires, they might be holding on to those.
Well, with 36 laps to go, we'll find out.
I heard a couple of cars had a couple of sets of tires left. Had two sets left. I'd definitely put a set on now.
It'd definitely be
11 different leaders. Remember, the record is 12 set back in 1995. We've had 13 lead changes, and the pits are open. And we mentioned Jeff Green will be the lucky dog winner. So he'll get back on the lead lap, and that will give us 26 cars on the lead lap. Anybody going to take a road?
Looks like the leaders are going to stay out.
Yeah, a little bit further back, though. Got a few cars coming. All right, we've got a chance. Let's talk to our in-race reporter, Tony Stewart.
Hey, Smoke, Dale Jarrett, do you have a copy?
Yeah, man.
Well, it looks like you once again have a hot rod there that's capable of winning. Your car owner and Junior, are they your biggest competition, you think?
Yeah, I definitely think so. I think, Kevin and I are got even cars here, obviously. I mean, it's awesome. It's hard to build a really, really good super speedway car, let alone build two of them, and they've done a good job of that. But I think you're right. I'd say the guys right in front of us are the worst ones we got to worry about right now.
Hey, Smoke, looking on TV, it really looks like these cars move around and slide around a lot. It's a handful to drive these things in the draft, right?
Yeah, it really is. It's, the hard part is you don't run as fast in practice as you do in the race because you don't get this many good cars together. But we've been fighting loose, and Butch and these guys have been doing a great job with this Oreos Rich Chevrolet, and we're getting tighter and tighter finally. So that's what we're working on, get it there where I want at the end of the day.
Hey, Tony, we were discussing up here whether anybody would pit right there, but how important are new tires? Does it really give you a much better feel of the race car?
Well, I think some of it. I mean, I think we can make it on fuel here. So guys are, it's kind of too early in a run to get the benefit of the tires and get yourself in bad track position. So it's just a matter of, we can make it to the end. So if everything goes right, we're in the position we want to be. But if we have to come pit and get tires later, we will. But right now, I think everybody's just trying to make it on what they got.
All right, man. It's been fun to watch. We'll be watching these next 35. Good luck.
All right, but thanks.
So the latest from Tony Stewart, and some really good information there as we're going to step aside for a break. And oh, man, as she makes her way over to the media center, look at the crowd. Even as she's out of the race, it never ends. Welcome back to the NASCAR Nationwide Series opener here at Daytona. And make sure to go to NASCAR.com for all your latest NASCAR information. Lights are out on the pace car. And Dale Jr. is our race leader right alongside Kevin Harvick, who is a 2007 winner here. Tony Stewart, who has won four out of the last five. And right behind him, Brian Vickers. We got a report from Jamie a little during the break. Vickers said, hey, what happens if we go three green-white checkers? Do we have enough fuel? And there's some other teams that, if that really were to come into play, it might be a key factor.
Yeah, they're thinking about it. They don't right now. They're thinking about just going the distance. But, they're thinking about the possibility of having to go the extra distance.
Well, we're about to find out. Also, can Dale Earnhardt Jr. win again in the Nationwide Series? It would be his sixth in this series here at Daytona. Boy, what a boost that would be for his 2010.
Oh, certainly would. But it's pretty interesting, the guys we've talked about the last couple of days that have won the last eight. We're up there right now.
There they are.
Top
one,
three.
Two, and three. Total of 26 cars on the lead lap. 12 cars are out of this race. Most of those in that 10-car pileup. Pace car getting ready to make the dive toward pit road. Dale Jr. has chosen the low inside line. brings them to the stripe. Green flag is out. We're racing again here at Daytona with 32 laps to go. On board with Harvick in the low line, starting to make a push. Just got word Brian Keselowski is going to get a pass-through penalty. He is 13th right now. He had a good run going. He passed before the start-finish line.
Yeah, the problem is he got hung behind the one car, James Buescher, who's having a problem on restarts. Didn't get going very good at all, and Brian just went around him, and then they got penalized for it.
Whoa, this is going to get interesting. Well,
could see smoke jump up there in the outside line trying to get a push from his car owner there, Kevin Harvick. He has his sights set on that 88 of Dale Jr.
That's as close as you want to see Vickers. Can't get any closer than that. Jr. right now is saying, okay, I've got mirrors full of everybody.
Well, this is where, as a leader, that you have to make the decision. You have to really be looking at which one of these lines might be moving quicker, and you want to get that push from that one.
Carl's sort of moving backwards, and there's the bump coming from behind by
Watch this. Here goes Stewart for the lead.
Tony's got the low line and no help for Junior. So here we go with another lead change. And right behind him is his teammate, Kevin Harvick. Junior tucks in to third. Vickers is going to say, come on, Kyle, punch me again from behind and let's go. It will be our 15th different lead change between 11 leaders. This has been a great start to the 2010 campaign in the NASCAR Nationwide Series. We hope you've been with us. We've got 30 laps to go.
See some contact through the corner.
We're at the bottom of the hour. If you're just tuning in, we will tell you that Danica Patrick was involved in the big one. Not her fault. She had nowhere to go, along with about 9 other cars. But this is the battle that we have going. As you can see, here comes smoke down low.
Starting to see a lot more bump drafting now. These guys are getting a little bit racy. We're getting down inside of 30 laps to go. Here comes that outside lane now. Harvick's leading that outside group.
Coming to the stripe, Tony Stewart's going to lead another lap. That is now his 12th lap led. Harvick has led the most today at 39.
You see him 3 wide just behind here. You see Brendan Gaughan there in the middle.
Not sure it's where Brendan wants to be by any stretch, but doesn't have much choice. Now he's trying to tuck in behind Kyle.
Now we see the momentum coming from that outside lane. Once again, just on the inside of Brendan Gaughan.
Look out!
Trouble.
Oh, and upside down is Earnhardt. This is going to be a mix.
Big spin behind us, wave him.
The 33 of Harvick. Joey Logano involved. More cars still spinning in this multiple car crash. Just that quick. Window net is down. Oh, man, that car is just destroyed.
Well, it happens fast. Hard to tell exactly what happened right there.
Brendan Gaughan involved in it. And we are going to get a red flag situation here.
See Kyle Busch coming down pit road with damage.
Yeah, he hit Junior after he'd gotten upside down. Another car that's coming in is the 09 of Scott Riggs. Look at the damage here. There is what's damage on the 33 of Kevin Harvick. So 2 of the 3 that have dominated this race the last few years are in some serious trouble. Dale is definitely out. I don't know how bad it is for Harvick right now. There's Brendan climbing out of his car.
Mike Wallace coming down pit road destroyed.
We'll have to see exactly what happened in this, but as we said, it's, as things start picking up and these guys start getting a little more aggressive with their driving and trying to take advantage of the draft, and these are the kind of things that happen, and they usually happen on the straightaway.
Every time it seems like these big wrecks happen on the straightaway.
That's a great sign there to see him out of the car. That's a wild ride. Yeah, he's just looking at it and saying,
trying to figure out what happened.
That was a beautiful race car just a few moments ago.
Junk now.
All right, let's go back, see how this all started. There's Dale right at the right side of your screen.
Oh, there's contact behind him between Carl Edwards.
And Carl Edwards got up into
Keselowski. And, boy, it just flipped Dale over. And then there's no but where for these guys to go. That's Kyle Busch. That's the damage he sustained. There's Brendan gone.
You got to wonder why Carl Edwards would make a move like that on the straightaway. He kind of made an abrupt move up to the outside lane there. I don't know if he thought he was clear.
Yeah, sometimes you're moving over just to get against that car to try to slow that car down, that momentum, to where you can get your line moving a little bit quicker. And maybe he just misjudged that. It has happened before, but that's what these guys are trying to do, is just side draft and slow that car beside them down to where their line will move quicker.
Greg Biffle also involved. Let's go on board. This is the view from Junior.
That's where he just got turned. It's, when you get hit in the right rear, there's nothing you can do. And, of course, the air automatically gets underneath that car right then. Let's see here. See Carl moving over. Yeah, I think he just, his intentions were just to get over there, but he could see that outside line moving a little bit just to slow them down. And I don't know if Brad came down just a little, nothing that Brad was doing wrong, but it only takes just a split second of both of these drivers moving in the same direction, and that creates the contact.
So the work continues. Let's go on board and just listen.
Corner, spin
behind you, Bannon. Turn it. All right,
we ain't
hit
nothing yet.
Gather
up.
It's from high above.
Yeah, Carl may have actually been trying to get in the outside lane there.
It looked like he thought he might have a hole. And was trying to get in that hole before it closed up, but he misjudged the front of his car.
You know, we've seen that a number of times down here this week in both the Cup Series and now in this series, to where guys are misjudging just a little bit. And it only takes a little bit.
Here it is in real time.
Yeah, I'm going to say, I think it's just a product of this restrictor plate racing. The cars are all bunched up. And just misjudging by a few inches can create a situation just like this.
If you were with us for Countdown, there was a really strong interview by Marty Smith with Dale Earnhardt Jr. and about the disappointment of last year and the high hopes for this year. And that's what's left of today's car. What does this do to his confidence?
Well, his confidence still got to be high. He had a car good enough to win and probably thought he was going to win. But that's just one of those racing breaks.
Our second 10-car crash, and you can see the list of those that are involved. There's the damage on Kyle's car. And looks like they've got the sledgehammer out trying to get it away from the wheel well. We are under a red flag situation here at Daytona. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
The NASCAR Nationwide Series from Daytona under the red flag. Our aerial coverage brought to you by DirecTV. DirecTV, it'll change your life. Call 1-800-DIRECTV. Under the red flag after a huge 10-car accident. Field stopped with 28 laps to go. Take a minute and look ahead in the schedule for the NASCAR Nationwide Series. Next week, it's all the way across the country. 2,500 miles to Southern California and the Auto Club Speedway. Then it's another West Coast venue, or a Western venue. Las Vegas Motor Speedway, a couple of weeks off, then Thunder Valley and Bristol Motor Speedway.
Oh, that's my place.
You
want
a couple
there.
Of
like
days, Russ? You like that place.
Oh, man, good place to hang out.
Want to join us at any of those upcoming races? Check out NASCAR.com/tickets, and, of course, all those races on the ESPN family of networks. This red flag happened for a race for second place gone bad, and another look at it with Rusty, Brad, and Ray, and how Carl Edwards clipped Brad Keselowski.
Yeah, for whatever reason, Carl moves up, hits the left rear of Brad. Brad hits the right rear of the 88 Dale Jr., turns him upside down, and then it's all crazy behind it. Brendan Gaughan comes plowing in, nowhere to go. Stephen Wallace goes by, no damage. There's Biffle. He tears his car up. Mike Wallace.
We took a lot of good cars out of the field right now, so
you're
it's going to be interesting.
And we agree with DJ's observation that it just looked like from that other angle, Carl was trying to get in line behind Keselowski in the draft.
Yeah, you can see right there, Carl's moving up, thought there was an opening and just hooked him. It turned Keselowski down into the 88. That left side weight of those Nationwide cars just picked that thing up, turned over, and then there is just nowhere to go. You can see a lot of things flying. There's a lot of hurt cars out there. Right now, we don't even know who has damage. They banged around so much.
We saw Dale Earnhardt Jr. climb from that battered race car and walk away okay. For more on driver safety, we go to our Craftsman Tech Garage and Tim Brewer. Tim?
Thanks, AB. You know, we were over at Hendrick Motorsports last week, picked up a pretty good piece here for the Craftsman Tech Garage. Randy LaJoy, he makes a great aluminum seat, but it's driver preference. But when you go over to Rick Hendrick, he's got this new carbon seat. The seat itself is a lot stronger. There again, the insert, it's molded to each individual driver, the contour of his body. But like you said, as long as you stay within the confines of this cocoon right in this area, with the Hans device, with the helmet, seat belts, you're going to be in pretty good shape. Another option that they have, this foam in the side of the car, it's optional in the NASCAR series as far as the Nationwide cars. Put it in either side, but it is mandatory in the Cup series. So when the car went up, when it came down on the pavement, this energy-absorbing foam, it withstood some of the shock. But Earnhardt, as long as he stays inside that car, he's going to be in good shape. Doc?
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr., walking out of the care center, I saw you smile, so I know you're okay. What all happened out there?
I don't know. I got turned in the right rear quarter panel. I guess you know, a couple guys just got together, and it hooked somebody into me. And when my car rolled to the really disappointed for the Hellman's folks. We were having a good run, and I felt pretty good about our chances of winning the race or running up front. It was a lot of fun. Drafting with Tony and Harvick and me and Harvick, he got loose down there, but we had a lot of fun today. But that was expensive right there, so I don't know. I'll have to go back and balance our books after this one. It's been a rough day for JR Motorsports.
Now, with you back here, can anybody out there handle Tony?
I think I don't know who was in the wreck, so I'll just have to go back to the bus. I mean, Tony's car is great. He's got awesome motor under the hood, and you know, he's one hell of a driver, so, you know, it's going to be tough to beat him. But I felt like we were up there, you know, having a lot of fun. It was a good race, you know. I just don't want to tear my car up like that, but that's the risk you take when you get out there.
Okay, glad the junior's okay. The bottom line is they lost the race car, but he's going to be fine.
Good to see that Dale Jr. is okay. You know, watching the different angles of this replay gives you a couple different things to think about, Rusty. You were watching that angle.
Yeah, it actually looked like the 22 car, Brad Keselowski, was coming off the wall at the same time that Carl Edwards was going up, and they just collided. I mean, I can't say that's all Carl's fault. One more time, let's take a look at this.
A little bit of that side drafting going on, like DJ was saying before, everybody trying to get close to the fender of that other car. Yeah.
You could be right there. That's really interesting. I think it's just the turbulence in the air, both of those guys sucking up to one another and just created a bad situation.
Keselowski coming down to try and side draft off of Junior while Carl Edwards was trying to get in line behind him, and it didn't work out, particularly for JL Junior and Brendan Gaughan. Doc?
Well, Brendan climbed out, and now he and Joe Nemechek talking over what they saw. Let me ask you first, Brendan, what did you see out there?
I mean, I was sitting in the top 10. Our Toyota was running great. I mean, everything was looking good for us, right where you want to be, and that's the nature of Daytona. You know, even when you're up front, dangerous things happen. I saw Junior get turned in the middle. Like, I just saw him come in the middle of the two lines, and when I saw him turn sideways, I started to see the undercarriage. And knowing where I was sitting, I went, oh, I'm screwed. Toyota's coming back in a heap. So I feel bad. I mean, this is our first race with the Camry, and it was everything I expected and more.
Joe, how about you?
I was back behind that. I saw Junior flipping up in the air, and I thought I saw another car up in there, but, I mean, there was nowhere for me to go. We're nursing a car, missing a half a right front fender, so I got to stay behind somebody to keep up, and next thing you know, whatever hit me caught the front of the hood, and it's the first time I ever had a carburetor knocked off my car. I just want to say thank you to all the guys at DAB Constructors out there for their support in the Nationwide car and on the Cup car, and we're going to have a good day tomorrow.
And that's the best news. These guys can walk away and race tomorrow.
Thank you, Doc. The red flag withdrawn. The yellow flag is back out. We'll see which of the leaders will pit in just a minute. Work allowed to begin on some of the damaged cars like Kyle Busch and Kevin Harvick's, guys who had contended for the win in this race for so long.
It looks to me like Kevin Harvick can get this car fixed. He's got some left front damage. Looks like they got it about fixed now. Some air damage up there, Ray. And it looks like they're going to try to dress out also.
Yeah, they've got a lot of work to do. But you know what? It goes back to that wreck is still just a kind
kind of a physics lesson, isn't it? You just can't put two things can't occupy the same space at the same time.
Well, I can tell you one thing. When I first started racing, Dick Trickle told me one time when him and I got together, hey, it's your fault, it's my fault. I learned one thing. He put it in percentages. Brad Keselowski is probably going to take 30% of the blame, and Carl Whitner is probably going to take 70% on that one.
I think it's interesting, though. I think what we're going to see, though, guys, the race from here on out is going to be real interesting, because I do believe that the guys who get to move up position-wise are the guys who've taken good care of their cars all day and stayed out of these frays. So now we're going to see some different cast of characters outside of Tony Stewart and Brad Keselowski with a chance to race for a good position. Dave, what do you got for us?
Crew Chief Butch Hilton told me they definitely want the tires because there's so much debris out there, and I definitely want fuel. That new rule at the end of the race, green, white checker, makes me nervous. Top this baby off and get Tony out of here. Jamie?
Brian Vickers in the middle of your screen. Car is good. No extended damage from that last wreck. They're going to fill it up with Sunoco fuel. Four tires down below. Carl Edwards, who was at the beginning of that wreck, he didn't know what happened. Asked for them to retrace his steps. A lot of right front damage. You see them assessing it there. They're putting on four tires, putting in fuel, assessing what needs to happen. I expect Carl Edwards to come back in, guys.
So we're at Daytona. We're down to the final 27 laps, and who knows what's going to happen. Will we be seeing another frantic Daytona finish? Will we have more than one attempt at a green-white checker for the first time in the Nationwide Series? We're coming back in just a minute to Daytona Beach. Final 25 laps of today's NASCAR Nationwide Series race here at Daytona. When the race is done, stay tuned here on ESPN2. It's our Sports Center at Daytona, Daytona 500 preview. The defending champ of the 500, Matt Kenseth, joins us. We'll get reports from the garage on today's final practice. How will Jeff Gordon fare in a backup car? What does his team have to say? That and plenty more on our Sports Center at Daytona, Daytona 500 preview, right after the race finishes here on ESPN2. Marty, take us to the checkers.
And we're going to go green with we're working lap number 96 at this point of 120. And it is Stephen Wallace who is in front and taking the lead even on the restart here. He chose the high side. Casey Kane, the 38, the 4 of Tony Stewart right there along with Brian Vickers.
Casey Kane tried to throw a little block on Tony Stewart, but he was having none of that.
And here comes Tony. Boy, he just blows by on the high side of the 66.
And you see that yellow machine number 98 of Paul Menard comes from that last starting spot up there in about fourth or fifth right now.
Now remember, Wallace stayed out and he last pitted on lap 85, I think it was, yes. And the rest of them came in on 93, so.
Hey, Harvick's not out of this thing. You see, he's right there with him.
One guy who probably is definitely out is Kyle Busch. He's the first car one lap down. He's 21st right now, and don't know how good that car is going to be with the damage he sustained.
Yeah, and that 12 car, Justin Allgaier,
got a debris caution,
is not surprising.
Well, that's going to be good news for Kyle Busch. He'll get the lucky dog.
And I was just talking about Justin Allgaier, done great job. He sustained some damage early on in that very first incident, and has come back. He's got himself up in third spot right now.
So our 14th different lead change. Now our sixth caution comes out here at Daytona International Speedway. We've had a total of 29 laps under caution. Our red flag lasted 11 minutes. And as we mentioned, 28 cars have been bent up in one way, shape, form, or another today. It has been a lot of contact. Tell you that Colin Brown did come back out. His car looks like a modified. While we've got a chance, we'll talk about some drag racing, because you can see what's happening tonight with qualifying at the Craig and O'Reilly Winter Nationals in Pomona at 11 Eastern, and then the finals tomorrow at 8 Eastern. All of it on ESPN2. So that will give us 21 cars back on the lead lap with Kyle getting the lucky dog, and there he is. And like we said, we're still not sure how aerodynamically sound that vehicle will be.
Yeah, that's one of the problems. NASCAR needs to make sure when these cars leave the pit area that they got all these panels secure, because if not, they're going to have a debris caution about every other lap until they clean this up. There's a lot of cars running cripple out there.
Yeah, they are. As I look down the list, I see, you know, we showed Morgan Shepherd back at the start of this race. Wasn't able to start at the very beginning because he had a problem. But he did get it on the racetrack, and now he's sitting in the 23rd spot. And you say, well, that might not be so great, but somebody that's trying to run that has a very limited budget, each one of these positions means a good bit of money.
Well, we've got a chance with us under our seventh caution. The record's 11 back in 2006. We got a long way to go to catch up there. Let's talk to our in-race reporter, Tony Stewart.
Tony, Dale Jarrett, you have a copy?
Yeah, man.
Well, he always said that being out front was the safest place to be. I guess that's definitely true a few minutes ago, huh?
Yeah, I'm, you know, the hard part about leading and having them too wide right behind you is you don't know which lane to go to, so I was watching that pretty hard, and all of a sudden chaos broke out in the middle of a race, so it was definitely the best place to be at the time.
Hey, Tony, explain to our viewers, when you're in that situation looking back there, that's what you're doing more than looking out front, aren't you, trying to decide which line that you want to try to maybe block or get a push from?
Yeah, I don't recommend most of these people doing that on the freeway, but, you know, everybody, at least with our deals, going the same direction. But when you're leading, you probably spend, I'd say, 80% of your lap, honestly, looking in the back. I mean, you run around here enough, you know where you're at, and you know where you're going. It's just, you know, when you're leading, everything's dictated by what's going on behind you.
I know it took out a lot of good cars right there, but as you look back there, you feel your car is still strong enough just to stay there in the front?
Yeah, the car is. If I do my job, we'll be fine. You know, I really believe it's up to me right now because we've got a good enough car. I mean, this thing has been strong all day long, and Butch and these guys have done a great job in the pits, and they keep making adjustments and making it better for me, and I feel like my car is the best that it's been all day right now, so I feel like I got something I can joust with here.
Well, thanks for talking with us. If you say it's up to you, I like the chances. Pretty good. Pretty good record you got here, bud.
I feel too bad about it myself, but every race is a different scenario, so it's not given. By any means, I still got a lot of work to do.
All right, thanks for talking with us, Tony. Good luck. Now, Dave Burns is going to talk to your crew chief, Butch Hilton.
And, DJ, we're standing down here with Butch right now, who has a full-time gig, not in the Nationwide Series. He's on loan from Turner Motorsports in the Truck Series. What'd you think when you got the call to maybe drive to crew a Kevin Harvick car with Tony Stewart as the driver at Daytona?
Well, of course, that was a no-brainer. Yeah, I was real excited. Kevin hangs all the bodies for us and does a lot of work for us at Turner Motorsports, and we surely appreciate that. And nobody builds a finer race car than KHI and all the men and women there. They put a lot of effort into it, so I was just really thrilled to get the chance to do this. We won this race 5 years ago with Tony as his crew chief, so man, maybe we can get a little lightning in the bottle here. That'd be great.
A lot of history with him. They're trying to repeat history right now. Jamie?
Trent Owens is the crew chief for Brian Vickers. They sit second right now. So Tony Stewart just said he thinks it's up to him how this race finishes. Do you guys have anything for him?
I'd say he's pretty much correct. You know, Brian's done a good job. We got some damage coming into pit road, and we had to repair that and went to the back. He's done a real good job coming back through there. Dollar General Toyota's been good all week. You know, we've been lacking a little speed as compared to the four cars. So maybe him and Tony can get hooked up, end this thing on green flag, and they can fight it out amongst themselves.
Well, he's on sticker tires now, and the car's the best it's been all day. Vince?
You talk about somebody who's been dodging a bullet today. Justin Allgaier currently sitting third. Take a look at the tire. He had hit the wall earlier today, and it had put a toe in the car, and that is how the tire had been wearing. And look at that on the bottom of that tire. They ran about 20 laps, believe it or not, on that tire, and were able to get it in, get the damage fixed on the race car, get fresh set of tires on. So Allgaier now looking pretty good, sitting third right now with fresh rubber. Doc?
Well, Ernie Cope and these guys up here in Kevin Harvick's pit have had to repair three of the four corners of his Chevrolet. And now right now, Kevin talking to Ernie. Ernie, how good is the car? How close have you gotten it back?
I believe we got it good. We just did one lap there. And he said it drives just fine. So if we got it back to handling how it did before, I feel we can get back up there and contend for the win.
So if you get back up there, can you handle your teammate, Tony Stewart?
I don't know. It'd be fun to get up there and race with him. I think if we get up there, I think we'll give him a go for it.
Okay, and Kevin Harvick, by the way, very comfortable and very excited about how well the car is handling just on the one lap at speed.
Harvick in 11th position right now as we get ready for the restart here at the Drive for COPD 300 at Daytona. And a couple of shout-outs. How about Paul Menard? Started dead last in this field, has worked his way back up to 5th. Move a couple of spots back to 8th, and look at the 26 of Brian Keselowski. Now, remember when he got the pass-through penalty? Sometimes penalties end up helping you. He missed the big wreck because of it.
Yeah, the circumstances have definitely worked out for Brian Keselowski. See what he can do with it here.
Brian's best finish ever, 10th at Memphis, and that was several years ago, back in October of 2007. So this could be a very big payday for the 26 team with Brian Keselowski. Lights out, as we said, on the pace car. Let's reset it for you. You've got Tony Stewart on point, Brian Vickers, Justin Allgaier third, Casey Kane fourth, Menard is fifth, Stephen Wallace sixth, Logano is seventh, and as we mentioned, Brian Keselowski is eighth. Michael Annette and Brian Scott round out your top 10 as we will have 20 laps to go here at Daytona when we go back to Green Flag Racing.
Yeah, you throw out Tony Stewart, Brian Vickers, and Casey Kane there, and it's not guys in the rest of that top 10 that you would normally talk about here at Daytona, but they've got a great opportunity. This is restricted plate racing. Anything can happen. Usually does.
Well, and just back you up on that, the cautions come out in the last 10 laps in 9 of the last 10 Daytona races. We've got 20 to go now, and we're back to Green Flag Racing here at the World Center of Racing. Allgaier trying to stay right on Stewart's back bumper. Vickers looking for some help on the high side.
Yeah, and Justin Allgaier got a good start there and is able to give Tony a nice push.
Menard up to third right now. There's Carl ducking back into the low lane. Boy, for some reason, Vickers looks like he's just got an anchor tied to him right now.
Yeah, and I'm not sure how good his car is. We saw some damage on the front, and I'm not sure how good his car is going to be out front. He's going to have to wait and be patient and try to get himself up there late in the race. I'm not sure that he's fast enough to stay out front for very long.
Yeah, if he could find a good place to tuck in, like right here, if he could find a hole, get somebody in front of him, take some of that wind off the front of the car where he has the damage, he can keep up with this group.
Casey Kane getting a little loose, trying to keep from running up on him. In that second line now on the high line, Stephen Wallace takes over the point. And, boy, that line doesn't seem to be able to push very fast, very far.
Yeah, you see the Keselowskis running together, yeah. Brian and Brad.
When's the last time you saw Brian in front of Brad?
He's liking this.
And that's no slam
come
against
on,
Brian.
Come on, give me a shove here. Let's go. Been,
man, Brad,
oh, come
saying,
on, dude.
See you, brother.
Don't hang me out.
Bye-bye, bro. Show. If you can't count on your brother out here, who can you count on?
That just proves it right there. You'd hang your brother to win a race, wouldn't you?
Yeah,
pretty much.
Unfortunately, Brian is really hung out now by everybody, and he's backing up. There is Menard, as he has dropped back a few spots. Let's get an update on his car, Dave.
And just think how the weekend's gone for Paul. With the rainout on Friday, his team had to do some negotiations to even find him a spot in today's race. Then in the second caution, he's involved, and they're fixing damage. You can see the tape on that yellow car that they fixed. The rest of the day, fairly quiet, and they pitted for fuel on lap 93, which means they'll be good to go at the end if we get one or two or maybe three attempts at a green-white checker finish.
Tell you what, Kevin Harvick's not out of this race by no means. His car looks really fast right here. He's just looking for an opportunity.
Yeah, he has moved back up into the sixth position. Right in front of him is Casey Kane. Still in front, though, is Tony Stewart. He is the man to beat right now.
Yeah, another driver that I see up there is the 20 car, Joey Logano. If he can get a little bit of help, he might have something to say if Tony Stewart's going to win this race or not.
How about Kyle Busch? He's up to 10th, guys. Remember, he got the lucky dog, and he comes back, and it looked, I mean, they worked on this thing as soon as the red flag was lifted. He's backing up a little bit there as he drifts up, but still.
Oh, the right front of this car was destroyed. And for them to get it fixed, to get that lap back, and to now be contending for just a top 10 spot's a miracle.
Well, he dropped back to 12th as he got high on the track. Now he's back in line. Next time by, we'll have 16 laps to go. Let's get an update on Kyle Busch. Dave, what's going on?
The worst part of the damage for them was that the toe was out on that car, and it wouldn't track straight down the track. So they worked on that really, really hard. And Kyle just came
him on the radio and he says, I might have a tire down, but DJ, when that car's been worked out as much as it has and when it's as out of sync as it is, you feel a lot of things under there, don't you?
Yeah, you really do. And even though they might got the toe back, something's bent there to create that situation. So you're going to get a lot of different feels. He's probably just going to try to hang on here and get the most that he can out of it.
Yeah, with that damage, and especially the sheet metal damage up there on the right front, he's likely got some kind of rub, and you know, you don't want that thing to blow out, that right front tire to blow out.
Well, the other thing we're seeing is some of that tape is starting to come off and get loose, which means air's getting in underneath, and that's not good for the car either. Don't forget, we've got right after our race, Sports Center, a special edition from right here at Daytona. Alan Beswick getting ready to bring you all the latest news on what's going to happen tomorrow. And look at this action out on the track, nose to tail. It is getting very good.
Okay, we're 15 laps to go, Dale. I mean, what do you want to do? What position you want to be in at this point?
I like where Justin Allgaier's sitting right now, to be quite honest with you. But I see him getting really racy here. Some guys getting antsy, wanting to improve their position right now. I'm not sure that we've seen our last caution.
Now, remember, Allgaier's never won a Nationwide Series race. He is the Rookie of the Year from last year.
That Harvick just jumped out of line up on the outside now, looking for another spot.
He's going to need some help, or it's going to cost him.
He's on the outside of Casey Kane. If he can get some help from behind.
Now, I said that about Allgaier. Now, give me Tony Stewart out front about any time, but I'm saying if anybody's going to try to make a pass, I like where Allgaier's sitting.
Harvick gets the help from Brad Keselowski. Will it be enough?
Well, Harvick had to do something. He knew he couldn't win the race from the position he was in. He's got to move up in this line.
He cannot get past the 38 of Kane. Now he's in trouble. He's got another car coming up underneath him there, and they may get shuffled back even further. That was Menard in the 98.
Yeah, the problem he's going to have is his own car is pulling this group so fast, it's going to make it tough to go on that outside line and make a pass.
And you got some of these cars running behind Tony Stewart that are pretty satisfied to be in the position they're in. They're not going to pull out and get racy now where these cars can catch back up.
This time by, 13 laps to go. Harvick still on that high side. Keselowski right behind him trying to get some more help from Annette, who's third in that line.
Well, I saw Logano give just a little bit of an opening. You've got to be careful, especially through that tri-oval, that you don't give somebody that opening. Brian Vickers had a notion to stick his nose in there, try to take that spot away on the inside.
Take a look at some of these shots we're seeing. I've never seen so much tape on the front of race cars at Daytona in my life. You see this maybe at Martinsville, but they all look like short track cars banged up out there.
And we hope that doesn't happen. Want to stay lean, mean, and green, but we mentioned it once before. 9 of the last 10, we've had a caution in the last 10 laps. It's because we get very racy, very racy.
You could see Harvick make a little more ground there whenever Brad Keselowski was able to stay right on his bumper. But once he moved back away from him a little bit, he kind of stalled out.
But Harvick's waiting on the cars up front behind Tony Stewart to get antsy. Now move out of line. Pull up in front of him here.
What is going through Justin Allgaier's mind? Here he sits in second place. 12 laps remaining from potentially his first win and the first win for Dodge since 2007.
I'm hoping they didn't tell him anything about that tire that we saw a while ago.
Vince, what's the latest?
I'll tell you what, it's been an amazing run, and if Allgaier should happen to win this race, he'll have his crew to thank for it. They had damage on their race car before their very first pit stop of the day. At one point, they had to replace a damaged fitting on the valve cover. This crew has earned their position today, and Allgaier has driven the wheels off of it. They told him just a moment ago, you're in a perfect place. Snug up to that bumper. We'll see.
Well, remember, we told you at the beginning of this race, Cup regulars have won all but four of the races here. Chad Little won once. Randy LaJoy, a Nationwide regular, won it three times. And right now, Justin Allgaier could join an exclusive club as he sits in second place. But, man, I'm telling you, he's got a big task. That guy in that number four has been awfully strong.
Four is going to become about 30 feet wide here whenever it gets down time that they... We've seen guys in the past here try to pass Tony Stewart on the last lap. We saw Kyle Busch try to push him down to Daytona Beach, and it still didn't work last week. Last year.
Harvick still on that high side, and boy,
he's
Keselowski,
not
going to give up. Keselowski, he got loose coming out of four on that one himself. He really doesn't have any choice, but they just can't get in enough. just got word from NASCAR officials. Greg Biffle has been given the black flag as he has got water coming out from underneath the car. So obviously he's got radiator problems. So end of the day for Biffle, who looked very good early in this race until he, too, got into one of the accidents, the last big one. Next time by, 9 laps remaining. We keep an eye on Harvick and Brad Keselowski because they keep pushing on that outside, but they cannot make any ground. And look at Stewart now starting to open up a little ground over second place.
That could actually help the car behind.
We got
some momentum shifts.
Logano.
I'm not sure that's going to work, though.
Here comes Vickers tucking up. Whoa, and he gets into Allgaier.
Casey Kane had to get out of the throttle. He got bumped from behind.
This is helping Harvick, just like you said.
Allgaier showing me a lot, guys. He saved this car twice so far.
This is exactly what Kevin Harvick's looking for, is for things to get racy up front.
Here comes Menard on the inside.
He's in the middle. Here comes Menard on the inside. Right behind him, the 60 of Carl Edwards. But Allgaier stays in second. Logano way on the high side. He may get shuffled back.
Look at Harvick thread the middle.
Harvick's now hooked up with Vickers in the middle. Three wide coming out of the corner. Oh, look out. That was Kane getting loose. Now we've got 8 laps remaining. Oh, and a Kane gets loose again.
Yeah, that car's been a handful all day for Casey Kane. He's got himself in the worst position you could be with a bad handling car right in the middle.
Harvick.
Oh, look at him slide up the hill.
Oh,
still sideways.
Harvick and Vickers still hooked up, but not getting any help. And look at the 18 of Kyle Busch coming up underneath.
Unbelievable.
That is anything but aerodynamically clean. And here comes Harvick giving him help. First time Kyle's gotten help all day.
That's two crippled cars helping each other.
Keselowski's gotten down on the low side. He is right behind the 33. This time by, it'll be 7 laps remaining. And again, it's still about a car length separating first and second. Well, it was.
Not for long.
Allgaier really putting on a show for the sophomore.
He is, and he's hanging on to that car with everybody. He's beating on his rear bumper. They want to get there and get that chance to try to pass Tony Stewart.
Tony opens it up, coming down out of 2. But it seems like Allgaier's able to pull back up, coming through 3 and 4.
Yeah, and he's in a position, this young man. He hasn't ever been in this position. You're on your biggest stage. He's running for a championship. What's he thinking about doing here at the end?
And look at Harvick working the outside now.
He is the only nationwide regular in that entire top 9-10 cars. And Allgaier looking to maybe pick up his first win.
Now you see Carl Edwards has moved up in that outside lane in front of Harvick.
Robert Richardson gives way as he is involved in one of those accidents earlier. 6 laps remaining, and notice Stewart again coming out of 2 is able to open it up.
Yeah, his car is just so strong, but he doesn't want to get too far ahead of these guys because that will allow them to get a real run with this draft.
Kyle Busch gets hung down in the middle of this group.
He's going backwards as fast as he came forward there a few minutes ago.
Yeah, Kyle's hung out in the middle on the high side, Vickers and Kane.
One to the 98. 5 to go this time.
See, Allgaier really having a tough time off of 4 now, holding his car down. He's going to have to be careful. He'll open that spot up and then lose that, or somebody will get a nose under him and into him.
That was Allgaier's radio you heard. Speaking of Justin, there have been 3 men who have gotten their first nationwide series win here at Daytona. Dale Earnhardt back in 82 at the initial race, Chad Little in 95, and that guy in the front right now, Tony Stewart, back in 05. Stephen Wallace, he's got his hands full right now. That car's been through the war. Michael Annette with him there. Meanwhile, back up front, Tony Stewart, and the freight train continues to roll.
Yeah, and Harvick's still trying to just make something happen, trying to get himself in a position that somebody can help him get to the front.
On board with Harvick. He can see it. He just can't get to it.
Yeah, and the problem is part of his damage there on the front is probably hurting his car some.
98's with you.
Four laps to go here at Daytona in what has been a thrilling nationwide race. To back up the two duels, which were oh so close, could we have another photo finish at the stripe today? We're about to find out.
Look at Brad Keselowski drive that car, jumping around up into the fourth spot now.
Joey Logano side by side with the 33 of Harvick. Boy, the front four cars. Now Keselowski trying to get into that mix with
the
98.
Don't let them shuffle you. Don't let them shuffle you.
Keselowski's trying to figure which way he wants to go.
Now he just got shuffled
the wrong way.
Yeah, that's going to cost him. He's drifting up. Look out. Harvick's on the outside of him. He ducks down. But it cost him a couple of spots, and it's going to cost him even more.
You see Carl Edwards is getting a bump from behind by Brian Vickers, trying to keep his car straight.
Keselowski's never finished in the top 10 in the February race here at Daytona. He's going to have to get back on his horse to get back into the top 10 now.
See, Harvick's in the fifth spot now. He's just waiting for an opening. See Menard drop back there a little. I think he's getting back there trying to get a little bit of help from that 20 car of Joey Logano. See if they can make a run on Allgaier here.
No driver has come from 43rd to win the race. You saw it there. Paul Menard in third right now. Could make some history today if he can pull it off. There's your top six.
He's struggling.
Whoa!
There comes Logano.
He's
to the
loose. Man, you could see his hands hacks on. Joey Logano's going to go underneath him. They're going to go side by side. It's going to allow those first two to pull away.
Which will be good for Tony Stewart because it's going to be hard for one guy to make a pass without some help, for sure, as strong as Tony's car is.
Two laps remaining. Look out. Logano gets loose. Three wide coming through the corner.
Here comes Kyle Busch
now
back in the mix again.
Wide. Woo! Keselowski says, excuse me, pardon me, playing through, and he makes the pass, and Logano goes backwards. Down the backstretch, look at Carl Edwards trying to get into this mix as well. He finds himself in that third position. And now these three cars, they could pull away from these guys.
Well, they got one lap coming up here, coming to the white flag.
Who wins this race? White flag is out here at Daytona.
White flag here.
Two and a half miles.
Will Justin Allgaier pull out and will Carl Edwards go with him?
Does Tony Stewart win for the fifth time in 6 years? Does Justin Allgaier get his first ever nationwide series win? And does Carl win for the first time here at Daytona?
Yeah, you can see Carl back up, trying to get Paul Menard to give him a push here. He's going to try to go to the outside of Justin Allgaier.
Somebody's got to get up there to give him some help because Tony's trying to pull away.
Allgaier makes the block on Carl Edwards. He's trying to get that push to go by Tony Stewart. They have the momentum.
Allgaier's got the run on the high side. Does he get any help? Not right now. Now he's going to look low.
Here comes
Meanwhile,
Carl.
Got a crash. Kyle Busch, the 22 of Keselowski. While they spin, coming down the front straightaway, it's going to be all Tony Stewart.
And the checker flag is waving.
Kevin Harvick trying to duck underneath. Who gets second behind Stewart? It is Edwards. Harvick third. Allgaier fourth. Woo, what a finish.
Oh, my gosh. And now the caution's out.
Again, great job, Butch. Great job, guys. Proud of you. This thing was bad fast.
Tony Stewart's 15th Daytona win. It ranks third all-time behind Dale Earnhardt's 34, Bobby Allison 16, and he's tied with Cale Yarborough.
The guy's just so good. You give him anything close to a decent race car, and he's unbelievable.
Shines.
And Harvick comes back for a third-place finish.
Yeah, what a move he made down to the inside on that last lap. Almost got to second. All right, let's go back and show you what happened. And it looks like there's going to be some discussion in pit road again.
We can talk about what might have happened, but they obviously disagree with that.
Well, there's parts and pieces all over that backstretch.
But take it from now to time the truck race is going to start to get this place cleaned up for them.
All right, let's take another look at it. Watch the 18, the 22.
Well, Kyle's loose there.
Yeah, he gets loose.
Yeah.
Yeah. Keselowski didn't do anything there.
Oh, I think he thinks maybe Brad gave him some help, and he didn't.
Yeah. Coming to the checkered flag.
And here was the race coming out of four for the group up front. Look, watch Harvick.
See, Harvick dived all the way to the inside right here. Justin Allgaier was trying to figure out who to block, but he just didn't have Carl wide enough to do all that. Harvick almost gets the second.
And for the second year in a row, Carl Edwards finishes second. I guarantee he says it's like kissing your sister. Let's check in with Doc.
Now with Butch Hilton, the crew chief for Tony Stewart, what is it about you and Stewart? The magic is back.
Well, I think it's more about KHI and how strong their cars are. The men and women that work there, they just build incredible race cars. Earnhardt Childress Racing Engines, you can't say enough about them. How about that driver? He is the man. And Bob Jeffries spotting for us up there. Bob talked him through the last 15 laps, keeping the runs off of him. And what a great day. It was awesome for Oreo, Ritz Crackers. Really appreciate all their support.
Now, does Tony have you come sit in the pits tomorrow to keep that luck going?
No, I think Darian's got it figured out.
All right, head to victory lane. Congratulations.
Appreciate that, Jerry.
Jamie.
And Carl Edwards just crawled out of his race car. What a day. I know everybody wants to talk to you real quick, Carl. First of all, let's think back a little bit in the race. 12-car pileup, and you were one of the first ones involved. What happened there?
Well, I was trying to tuck back into line with Brad. And I think if you look real close, I haven't seen a replay, but I think at the last second, you know, when I was tucking in, he just moved over just enough. And once we got hooked, I did everything I could to get off him. I'm glad everybody's all right there. That's not what we wanted to be part of, but I'm really proud of my guys. Fastenal, Copart, Ford. I mean, second place, it's not a win, but it's a great start for our season. So I had a lot of fun out there today. I'm excited about the 500 tomorrow.
It was an exciting race for Carl Edwards. Let's go over to Vince Welch.
I'll give you an indication of what kind of day it was for Kevin Harvick. When he stepped out of the car, he brushed grass off his driver's suit. That was some kind of incident and some kind of recovery by your team. You had significant damage on your car.
Everybody on this Jimmy John Chevrolet did a great job. What a couple cars they prepared over the winter. We work hard on our speedway stuff, and to see the four in victory lane and this car tore up and come back to finish third says a lot about the character of the race team. So I'm excited. Been a long time since I slid that far and didn't just destroy something. So other than some minor damage, was a good day. So just got to thank all the fans and coming out to watch today, and good day.
It's amazing. We were listening on the radio during the red, and you were still confident your team could win the race, that you had a car that could win despite all the damage. What gave you that confidence from earlier?
I just knew we had a really fast car, and the car handled flawlessly all day. And, you know, I figured, I didn't know how bad it was tore up, actually, but I figured we had a good enough car to get back up there. The packs just weren't that big there at the end, and there was no outside line, so you kind of had to push and shove to get back to the bottom.
Great day for KHI.
It certainly is. In the sixth Restrictor Plate Nationwide Series victory for Tony Stewart, ties him with Dale Earnhardt and Dale Earnhardt Jr. for the most all time. They have got that program figured out.
Yeah, I'll say they do.
Well, it has been one exciting day. And it's almost time for our Hellman's Victory Circle as Tony is unbuckling and getting ready to climb out of the cockpit of that winning number four Chevrolet. And here he comes. Dave Burns, it's all yours.
And for Tony Stewart, the emotion of Daytona is all his once again, thanking his mostly Stewart Haas race crew. But are you surprised to be here based on everything that was put together for you here this weekend?
Not because of, I'll be honest, no, and that's because of the equipment I was given. I'm not sure I still did a good enough job behind the wheel, but man, this Oreos Ritz Cracker Chevy was awesome. Man, was this thing awesome. And everybody from Coke and all of our guys from the Office Depot Old Spice team came and helped out today. But, you know, this is really because of Kevin and Delana Harvick and everybody at Ritz and Oreos for letting us come do this with them. Kevin and Delana have always given us great race cars. I mean, every time. So from that standpoint, no, I'm not surprised, but just glad we're here again.
I heard you ask with five to go, how many laps? You're good at this, but how difficult is it to hold guys off at the end like that?
Well, you know they're not going to just sit there and ride and stay where they're at. Everybody's going to try to win it, so you just got to have an idea how much longer you got to do what you're doing.
All right, Tony Stewart, 5 of the last 6 in victory lane here in the Nationwide Series. He does it again today. Vince.
Well, Tony Stewart ended up in victory lane, but he sure had to hold off Justin Allgaier to do it. What's going through your mind there in those final laps when you're on the bumper of Tony Stewart and a bunch of other Cup guys are on your tail?
Well, just follow the four. You know, I told Tony, or I had Spotter tell Tony before that last restart that if we can get rolling, we'll push him out there and get it, you know, get him as far ahead as we can. But Verizon got Dodge guys did just an unbelievable job. I got in the wall early and I thought I ruined our day. We had an oil leak. We had to come in and fix it and fix the damage. And just to be there at the end and to know that how far this team's come from last year and just know how far we've come, it's pretty awesome. And his Spotter did an unbelievable job. He was up there, you know, just telling me how far back and how forward we needed to go. So God was definitely on our side today, that's for sure.
Terrific effort for Justin Allgaier and the Verizon Dodge today. Marty?
All right, we're catching our breath up here. A lot of excitement. The celebration will go on for quite a while. And we put the first one in the books for 2010. Make sure to tune in next week when we head west for the NASCAR Nationwide Series at California. We'll be on the air Saturday at 5 Eastern on ESPN2. Congratulations again to Tony Stewart for our entire ESPN crew. I'm Marty Reed. Till we meet again, right now we go to Sports Center at Daytona. We're going to send it over to Alan Beswick in the pit studio. Alan, it's all yours.